Preface. The book is derived from a series of talks on Enhedhama which were presented on my trips to Canada and America in 2002. As the audience found these talks immensely useful and relevant to their daily lives, I feel it is vital to preserve the precious teachings Dhamma, handed down from the Buddha's omniscient wisdom, to be available to all. Hence the idea of putting these talks into a book came to me. Enhedhama appears dull, complicated, difficult to understand, irrelevant to most, in daily life and meditation practices. Therefore it is largely ignored. I intend to make Abhidha MMA easier and accessible to all, by using simple, direct language to explain the profound Enhedhama concepts, while keeping the essence of Dhamma. In this way, I have extracted the essence of Enhedhama and relate the importance of it to one's daily life and meditation practice, putting them into context that is easily understood. It is my sincere wish that this book reaches and benefits more people, assisting them to acknowledge and receive the immense value and usefulness of Enhedhama in the path leading to happiness, both mundane and supramundane. I hope the effect of this Dhamma will enable you to understand the subtle workings of your mind, so that it will inspire you with the spiritual urgency to avoid evil, do good and purify your mind, which is the core teachings of the Buddha. The practical aspects of Enhedhama set out in this book are attributable to the most respectable Venerable U3/4 Chöwo Apa Aktaya Sayadaw from his many years' experience of teaching Samatha and Vipassana meditations based on Enhedhama. I shall also be sharing with you many of the actual insights experienced by meditators at Pa Ak Forest Monastery. I would like to acknowledge my indebtedness and utmost gratitude to my master, Tihi Most Venerable Pa Aktaya Sayadaw, who had untiringly taught me Enhedhama and meditation. He encouraged this project with innumerable helpful suggestions and he rejoiced with me in its completion. My appreciation to him is beyond what words can adequately express, as he has patiently and unfailingly guided me in the Dhamma during my long years of association with him. Acknowledgement is gratefully made to the helpful contributions to this book by the following works mentioned in the bibliography, in particular, A Comprehensive Manual of Enhedhama by Bhikkhu Bodhi and the works of Pa Aktaya Sayadaw. I would like to thank profusely Maureen Bodenbach, without whose help this book would not have materialized. She accompanied me on the teaching trips for the entire 4 months in Canada and America, taking good care of my physical well-being, assisting me with the English language, doing the typing and taking great pains to draw the diagrams and charts. My special thanks to Tilaka Dezoisa and her group for so kindly provided for most of my needs. When I left America, the first draft of the book was completed. I thank Venerable Yukuo Dairasa Sedena for helping with the correct fonts. I would also like to acknowledge the following people who had graciously given their effort and time to help me with this book: Eddie Barron, Casey Go, Teo Su Chen, Ingwai Chong, Joey Chong, Dorothy Su, and Kim Lim. Finally, my special appreciation to Loreen Lam, whose contribution may guess this final version possible. I solely take the total responsibility for any inaccuracy in words or content in this book with regards to the Dhamma. I dedicate all merits accrued from this book to my teachers, parents, relatives, friends, readers and all who had contributed to this work in one way or another. May these merits be shared with all sentient beings. May all beings be well and happy. May all beings be able to practice the threefold training of morality, concentration and wisdom, appropriately and successfully. Sile Su Silo. Pa Ak Forest Meditation Center Malamayine, Mon State. Myanmar, December 2004. Forward. Bhikkhus, I say that the destruction of the taints is for one who knows and sees, not for one who does not know and see. For one who knows what, for one who sees what does the destruction of the taints come about? The destruction of the taints comes about. One, for one who knows and sees, this is the noble truth of suffering. Two, for one who knows and sees, this is the noble truth of the origin of suffering. 3. For one who knows and sees, this is the noble truth of the cessation of suffering. 4. For one who knows and sees, this is the noble truth of the path leading to the cessation of suffering. It is for one who knows thus, for one who sees thus, that the destruction of the taints comes about. Therefore, Bhikkhus, an exertion should be made to understand, this is the noble truth of suffering. An exertion should be made to understand, this is the noble truth of the origin of suffering. An exertion should be made to understand, this is the noble truth of the cessation of suffering. An exertion should be made to understand, this is the noble truth of the path leading to the cessation of suffering. This is the Asavakaya Sutta, the destruction of the taints of the Sakasa section Yutta. In this sutta, the Buddha taught that without having realized the Four Noble Truths, the destruction of the taints is impossible, but having realized the Four Noble Truths, the destruction of the taints is possible. If a meditator wants to realize the destruction of the taints or to become a noble one, Bhariya, he must first realize the Four Noble Truths. Among these four, the noble truth of suffering, Dukkhasukha, and the noble truth of the origin of suffering, Samudayasukha, are the objects of insight knowledge by Vipassana. First of all, a meditator should try to realize the noble truth of suffering. What is the noble truth of suffering? In the Dhammacakkappavattana Sutta, the setting in motion of the wheel of the Dhamma, the Buddha explains in brief that the five aggregates of clinging are suffering. And in the Mahasatipanana Sutta, the great sutta on the four foundations of mindfulness, he explains, and what bhikkhus, in brief, are the five aggregates of clinging. They are as follows. 1. The materiality aggregate of clinging. 2. The feeling aggregate of clinging. 3. The perception aggregate of clinging. 4. The mental formations aggregate of clinging. 5. The consciousness aggregate of clinging. In this book, the author compiles information from the Pali texts to help the reader understand these five aggregates, which are equivalent to consciousness, mental factors and matter, and thus lay a foundation for a basic understanding of Anhedhamma. The Anhedhamma's function, on the other hand, is to provide a unified and detailed picture, or map, of the five aggregates from the perspective of ultimate mentality and ultimate materiality. Without such a map to guide one's progress, one may easily fall prey to the numerous pitfalls of wrong view and never arrive at a correct understanding of the first noble truth. Before one can realize Nibbana, the third noble truth, one needs to know and see not only the first noble truth but also the second noble truth, the noble truth of the origin of suffering. In the Tithayatana Sutta of the Egadara Nikoyaya, the Buddha explains the second noble truth as follows, and what bhikkhus, is the noble truth of the origin of suffering. With ignorance as condition, volitional formations come to be. With volitional formations as condition, consciousness. With consciousness as condition, mentality materiality. With mentality materiality as condition, the six sense bases. With the six sense bases as condition, contact. With contact as condition, feeling. With feeling as condition, craving. With craving as condition, clinging. With clinging as condition, becoming. With becoming as condition, birth. With birth as condition, aging and death, sorrow, lamentation, suffering, grief and despair come to be. This is the origin of the whole mass of suffering. This bhikkhus is called the noble truth of the origin of suffering. When one's Vipassana insight knowledge matures through the fourth noble truth, the noble eightfold path, one knows and sees the unconditioned element, asayakata dhotu, nibbana. Thus, one realizes the third noble truth. There are four levels of path knowledge which destroy the taints, or defilements, stage by stage. At each stage, the meditator's understanding of the four noble truths grows clearer and clearer, gradually dispelling the clouds of ignorance that have shrouded the mind in darkness for so many lifetimes. The author presents the four noble truths in the Anhedhamma's perspective, which is the most profound way to explain the Dhamma, with practical examples from various angles, in great clarity that can be easily understood by the average person. It also enables one to make sense of the Buddha's teachings from another perspective. It is empowering and enlightening as it relates, links, and provide the rationale to one's life experiences, meditation practice experiences, and the intellectual understanding of the Dhamma, regardless of whichever traditions and creed one is from. I highly recommend this book to those who wish to gain a comprehensive understanding of Anhedhamma and its benefits, not only in the practice of meditation, in the direction of one's life, but also in one's daily activities. The reader will find this book transforming since the author had clearly explained which types of activities are wholesome and which types are unwholesome. Furthermore, she gave the rationale and the consequences of committing them. For a Buddhist to understand which activities are wholesome, kusala, and which activities are unwholesome, akusala, is very important. Only endowed with this understanding, will one be able to accumulate wholesome dhammas for one's own benefits as well as others, and avoid accumulating unwholesome ones. Among the wholesome dhammas described in this book, the threefold training of morality, S2LA, concentration, samadhi, and wisdom, panyo, is most vital. Without this threefold training, there is no path. And without the path, there can be no path knowledge. Without path knowledge, there can be no cessation of suffering, so one cannot possibly liberate oneself from the cycle of sa-sekshansarik existence. Therefore this threefold training, in fact, is the one most essential dhamma for the attainment of nibbana. May all living beings find the opportunity to undertake this threefold training, and may they experience the timeless peace and happiness of nibbana. Paaktaya Sayada. Paaktaya Monastery. Unraveling the mystery of mind and body through the Anhedhamma. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Homage to him, the exalted, the worthy, the fully enlightened one. CH.1 Introduction. Mind leads the world. How true is it? Only when we understand how the mind works will we be truly convinced. Mind is something so close to us, and yet so far from our understanding. Mind is the culprit behind all of our unwholesome bodily actions and speech, and it is also the director of our good behavior that soothes everyone's heart. The study of Anhedhamma helps us to understand how the mind works, which is the essential factor for us to lead a happy and blameless life. In Anhedhamma, the ultimate reality of mind and matter, which makes up this so-called being, is minutely defined into the process of its momentary arising and passing away, dependent on causes and conditions. Thus, the study of Anhedhamma also helps to shed the illusion of I or of a permanent self. Most of the problems in life spring from the ignorance and craving of I or the self-centeredness of I. However, when one understands that there is no I in the ultimate sense through practical meditation experience based on Anhedhamma, one will be able to let go of the intense clinging to it. The Anhedhamma Paaka, one of the three collections TPAKA, is an exposition of ultimate realities in detail. Anhedhamma is a combination of two words, abhi and dhamma. Abhi means higher, special, or sublime. Dhamma means ultimate realities or teachings. Hence, Anhedhamma is that which exceeds and is distinguished from the dhamma. Why? It is because all dhammas are fully classified and explained by the Buddha in Anhedhamma, but is only partially expounded in suttas. It is the precious teaching of Buddha's unimpeded omniscient knowledge, Savanuttanyoa, acquired through a long period of 4 incalculable aeons, Asaukeya, and 100,000 aeons, Kappas. The Theravada tradition regards the Anhedhamma as the most perfect expression of the true nature of existence that had been apprehended by the penetrative mind of a fully enlightened one. Anhedhamma expound the higher teachings that deals only with ultimate realities, or truths. According to the Anhedhamma philosophy, there are two types of truth. 1. Conventional truth, Samyutti Sakka. 2. Ultimate truth, Paramattha Sakka. 1. Conventional truth. Conventional truth refers to ordinary conceptual thought or commonly accepted truth, like tree, house, table, men, women, persons, beings, etc. This is the everyday language we use. We think that these things are something real, that they actually exist. Yes, they seem to exist, but if we examine conventional truths closely, we will find that they do not exist as irreducible realities. We can extract ultimate truth from conventional truth. This can be actualized by the practice of Four Elements Meditation 1. Initially, the meditator discerns repeatedly the four elements, earth element, water element, fire element, and wind element, from the head down to the soles of the feet again and again. When the concentration deepens and approaches access concentration, Upakara Samadhi, he will see different kinds of light from gray to white, and then the whole body will appear as a white form. If he continues to discern the four elements in the white form, the whole body becomes transparent like an ice block. When he looks for space within the transparent block, the transparent form breaks down into thousands of billions of particles, called repakalopas, subatomic particles. The size of one repakalopa is smaller than an atom. With the strength of access concentration, one can penetrate into each particle and find that it contains at least 8 elements called puroctad kalopa. Some have 9, 10, or more elements as in bodhidikad kalopa. 1. For detail practice, refer to 4 element meditation in samatha section. Ropa kalipa in the body chart 1. The puroctad kalopa. 1. Earth element pathapotu. 2. Water element opadhotu. 3. Fire element Tejadhotu. 4. Wind element Boyodhotu. 5. Color Bhavava, the body Dikad Kalopa. 6. Smell Ganda, 1. Earth element. 7. Taste Rasa, 2. Water element. 8. Nutritive essence Ojo, 3. Fire element. 4. Wind element. 5. Color. 6. Smell. 7. Taste. 8. Nutritive essence. 9. Life Faculty 10. Body Sensitivity. The 8 elements of the pure octet kalopa are called inseparable elements, avinibhogaripas, and they are the final, irreducible components of existence. They cannot be subdivided again. Therefore they are called ultimate realities. When the body is penetrated deeply inside, what can be found is only a group of ultimate realities. The body is only a concept, or conventional truth. So are external inanimate things like mountain, house, table, etc. They are a combination of these 8 elements produced by temperature. How is matter produced by temperature? The fire element in each kalopa, when it reaches the static stage, produces new generations of repakalopas, and this process keeps repeating itself. This is called matter produced by temperature. This can be realized by the practice of 4 elements meditation. Thus, by penetrating the conventional truth with concentration and wisdom, one eventually reaches ultimate truth. 2. Ultimate truth. What is ultimate truth? Ultimate truth means something that cannot be changed or subdivided into other things. It is something that really exists by reason of its own intrinsic nature, sabhueva. For example, the earth element in our bodies, as well as in inanimate things, exists in nature with the characteristic of hardness. Hardness is the intrinsic nature of earth element. The fire element exists in nature with the characteristic of heat. Each element in one repakalopa has its own intrinsic nature. They are the final, irreducible components of existence. They are themselves the final terms of analysis. So are consciousness and mental factors, which together are called noma, the mind. The successive coming into existence of this noma and repa, mind and matter, in combination, is called a human being, or a deva, or a brahma, or a person, I, man and woman, animal, etc. Human, is conventional truth, consciousness, mental factors and matter are ultimate truths. Ultimate truths are subtle and profound dhamma and cannot be seen by the naked eye, but they can be penetrated by a mind well trained in concentration and wisdom. In Inhidhamma, ultimate reality is fourfold. 1. Consciousness, citta. 2. Mental factors, cetasika, conditioned dhamma. 3. Matter, repa. 4. Nibbana, unconditioned dhamma. Ch.2 Consciousness. What is the meaning of consciousness, citta? Many people do not understand the actual meaning of consciousness. They identify consciousness as I. When seeing consciousness arises to perform the function of seeing, they say, I see, or she sees. When your consciousness arises to perform the function of hearing, they think, I hear, or she hears. When tongue consciousness arises because of the impingement of the tongue sensitivity and tastes, they say, I taste, or she tastes, etc. Actually, consciousness is just awareness of an object. It is defined as pure awareness of an object, knowing an object, or the process of cognizing an object. Here, awareness, or knowing, does not mean comprehension by knowledge or wisdom. It means simply the ability to take in objects through the sense organs or sense sensitivities. Apart from the process of cognizing an object, there is no soul or self who hides behind or exercises control over the whole process of seeing, hearing, tasting, etc. The knowing of an object is the characteristic of consciousness. Its function is to be a forerunner of the mental factors in that it presides over them and is always accompanied by them. It manifests in the meditator's experience as a continuity of processes, sandhana. Its proximate cause is mind and matter, as no consciousness can arise without being accompanied by mental factors and matter. 1. In Pali, mano, citta, and vool have the same meaning as consciousness. In a snap of the fingers, thousands of billions of moments of consciousness arise and pass away. So consciousness arises at tremendous speed, one after another. 2 or 3 moments of consciousness cannot arise at the same time. Owing to the rapid arising and cessation of consciousness, when we watch the news on television, it seems that listening and seeing happen at the same time. We do not know that seeing consciousness and hearing consciousness are occurring at different times, one cognitive process after another. Although consciousness arises and ceases at tremendous speed, every consciousness goes through the same 3 stages, arising, upaveda, static, hidai, and dissolution, bhaga. Arising is birth, static is decay, and dissolution is death. In the ultimate sense, we live only for one conscious moment, and not from conception up to death, which is the conventional truth. Actually, with each moment of consciousness we are reborn and we die. The 3 sub-moments of one consciousness. Citta. Arising, static, dissolution, birth, decay, death. Classification of consciousness. A consciousness can be classified with respect to its nature, jyoti, in four ways, I. Unwholesome, akusala. E. Wholesome, kusala. E. Resultant, vipoka. IV. Functional, kriya. I. Unwholesome consciousness. There are 12 types of unwholesome consciousness, Appendix 1, 8 rooted in greed, 2 rooted in hatred, and 2 rooted in delusion. Unwholesome consciousness is rooted in either one or two of the three evil roots, greed, lobha, hatred, dosa, and delusion, MOHA. For example, a man joyfully has. 1. The exception is in the immaterial realm, where there is no matter. Intercourse with an underage girl, holding the view that there is no evil in his sexual misconduct. Such unwholesome bodily action is rooted in greed and delusion. Sometimes the same action may be accompanied by neutral feeling. Another example is when a person, out of rage, utters harsh speech to hurt another's feelings. Such unwholesome verbal action is rooted in anger and delusion. Unwholesome consciousness rooted in hatred is always accompanied by displeasure. Greed and hatred cannot coexist in the same mind moment or same cognitive process, as their nature opposes each other. Greed has the nature of grasping and holding on, while hatred has the nature of pushing away and destroying. Delusion is always present in every unwholesome state as an underlying root. It is mental blindness towards what is good or bad, or the ignorance of the nature of conditional phenomena. There are two types of consciousness rooted solely in delusion. One is associated with doubt and the other with restlessness. If one doubts the working of karma and its results, that good begets good, bad begets bad, this is unwholesome consciousness associated with doubt rooted in sheer delusion. Letting one's mind wanders at will without controlling it is unwholesome consciousness associated with restlessness rooted in sheer delusion. Both consciousness rooted in delusion are accompanied only by neutral feeling. With the exception of consciousness associated in restlessness, the remaining 11 unwholesome consciousness are potent enough to cast one to the four woeful planes. Unwholesome action, speech and thought are always prompted by unwholesome consciousness rooted in greed, hatred, and delusion. In P plus or minus Li, unwholesome is called akusala. Why do we call it akusala? Because it is mentally unhealthy, morally blameworthy, leads to one's own affliction, or the affliction of others, or the affliction of both, and productive of painful result in the present life as well as the life after. 2. Wholesome consciousness. There are 8 types of sense sphere wholesome consciousness, Appendix 2, either rooted in 2 or 3 of the 3 wholesome roots, non-greed, alobha, non-hatred, adosa, and non-delusion, amoha. For example, a boy spontaneously and joyfully offers some fruits to the monk upon seeing him coming for alms round. He understands that this is a wholesome deed that would produce good result. His wholesome bodily action is rooted in the 3 wholesome roots of non-greed, non-hatred, and non-delusion. Being able to give up or having non-attachment to his belonging is manifestation of non-greed or generosity. The goodwill and kindness he has for the monk is the manifestation of non-hatred or loving-kindness. The knowledge of karma and its result is manifestation of non-delusion or wisdom. But if the same action is performed without knowledge of karma and its result, and with neutral feeling, it will be rooted in the 2 wholesome roots of non-greed and non-hatred, but without non-delusion or wisdom. When such wholesome action or karma ripens, he will be reborn as a rich person, but possibly dull-witted, without much joyful feelings. For those who practice concentration and attain absorption are those who are able to discern the 3 characteristics of impermanence, suffering and non-self nature of mentality and materiality, their wholesome consciousness is always accompanied by the 3 wholesome roots of non-greed, non-hatred and non-delusion. In Pali, wholesome is called kusala. Why do we call it kusala? Because it is mentally healthy, morally praiseworthy, does not lead to one's own affliction, or the affliction of others, or the affliction of both, and productive of pleasant result in the present life as well as the life hereafter. 3. Resultant consciousness. Both sense sphere wholesome and unwholesome consciousness constitutes karma. And the result of these two is called resultant consciousness, vipoka citta. For example, the 5 types of sense consciousness such as eye consciousness, ear consciousness, and so on, as well as rebirth consciousness, paisandhi citta, and life continuum, bhavaga, are all resultant consciousness. They arise due to past wholesome and unwholesome karma. IV. Functional consciousness. Functional consciousness is neither karma nor the result of karma. It involves activity that is not capable of producing kamagara salt. So both resultant and functional consciousness is karmically indeterminate. For example, five-door adverting consciousness, which adverts to the five sense objects, is functional consciousness. When arahants perform an action, such as serving the teacher, preaching a sermon, teaching meditation, and practicing samatha and vipassana, their consciousness is also functional consciousness, which is incapable of producing its results since an arahant has eliminated all the defilements. Kama will produce result only when it is supported by craving. Arahants have uprooted all cravings, hence their actions are incapable of producing any results. Cognitive process pathi. Consciousness occurs in two ways. 1. Cognitive process, sitavati, a five-door cognitive process. B. Mind-door cognitive process. 2. Process freed, vidamita, on the occasion of rebirth, bhavaga, and death. Before discussing the cognitive process, first we need to understand bhavaga or life continuum. Bhavaga is the combination of two words, bhava and aga. Bhava is existence, aga is factor, so bhavaga means factor of existence, which is the indispensable condition of existence. The function of bhavaga consciousness is to preserve the continuity of the mental stream through the duration of any single existence, from conception to death. Within one lifetime, the first bhavaga is called rebirth consciousness, and the last bhavaga is called death consciousness. The bhavagas which arise in between rebirth consciousness and death consciousness are called bhavaga consciousness. They are resultant consciousness produced by previous kama. When there is no cognitive process taking place, the bhavaga consciousness, which are process freed, arise and pass away every moment during life to preserve the continuity of existence. This is because the mental stream cannot stop flowing, as the causes for its arising are still intact, that is, the kama that produces this life is not yet exhausted. Cognitive process is active because of the force of greed, hatred and delusion, or non-greed, non-hatred, and non-delusion. Rebirth death. In between cognitive processes, the mental stream cannot stop. So what maintains the continuity of consciousness? Rebirth death www. Bhavaga consciousness arises between two cognitive processes in order to maintain the continuity of consciousness of existence between birth and death. It is the passive phase of consciousness as compared to the cognitive process. There is an occasion when the mental stream can be temporarily cut off when an anagom or an arahant enters into attainment of cessation, nirada samapatti. But attainment of cessation can only be realized by an anagom or arahant who possesses the eight attainments. Point 1. Sometimes they may feel weary of the constant arising and passing away of mind and matter, and so will enter into attainment of cessation, to stop the arising of mind and consciousness-born matter for perhaps 1 day, 3 days, or up to 7 days according to their prior determination. The mental stream is cut off completely and forever only after the parinibbana of an arahant, since the defilements that produce the round of rebirths have been uprooted completely by the arahant path knowledge. Since bhavaga sita is resultant consciousness, it is the passive phase of consciousness. It takes as its object the sign of the near-death cognitive process of the immediate past life, refer to the process of rebirth and death. Since the object is not a present life object, we are not aware of it, just like we are not aware of our past life. When we are in deep dreamless sleep, bhavaga sittas will arise and pass away in every moment, flowing on like a stream to maintain the continuity of existence. Bhavaga siddhas also arise in between two cognitive processes, after one finishes and before another arises. New practitioners, when developing their concentration on the meditation object, owing to the weakness of mindfulness, sometimes let their minds fall into the bhavaga state. At that time they are not aware of anything except feeling peaceful. Some mistakenly think that mind and matter have stopped. Actually at that moment bhavaga siddhas arise successively. They are unable to discern them because of the subtlety of bhavaga mind states. Now that we understand the function of bhavaga, let us go back to the occurrences of consciousness in the cognitive process. There are two types of cognitive processes, five-door cognitive process and mind-door cognitive process. Five-door cognitive process. Five-door cognitive process includes 1. Eye-door cognitive process. 2. Ear-door cognitive process. 3. Nose-door cognitive process. 4. Tongue-door cognitive process. 5. Body-door cognitive process. 1. The eight attainments are: 1. First jhana, 2. Second jhona, 3. Third jhona, 4. Fourth jhana, 5. The base of infinite space, okosoina koyatana, 6. The base of infinite consciousness, bioa koyatana, 7. The base of nothingness, uikicaoyatana, 8. The base of neither perception nor non-perception, nevasa onuisaoyatana. When siddhas arise cognizing an object at the sense doors, they do not occur at random but occur in a series consisting of 17 separate moments of consciousness that arise one after another in a certain order, which is in accordance with the fixed law of consciousness, or sita niyoma. Iador cognitive process. When no active cognitive process is taking place, the bhavaga sita flows on one after another continuously. At that moment when a visible object impinges on the eye sensitivity and bhavaga simultaneously, the series of 17 moments of consciousness called Idor cognitive process runs as follows. 5. Door cognitive process chart 2. Idor cognitive process. Object, visible object. Process freed, 14 moments of consciousness act as cognitive process. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 1, 6, 1, 7. Wholesome and unwholesome kama are performed at the jivana stage. The visible object and eye sensitivity perish together with RG consciousness. Note, each circle represents one consciousness moment. The three bullets below each circle represent the sub-moments of each consciousness moment, arising, static, and dissolution. P equals past bhavaga, B equals vibrating bhavaga, E equals arrest bhavaga. F equals 5 door adverting consciousness, E equals eye consciousness, RC equals receiving consciousness, I equals investigating consciousness, D equals determining consciousness, J equals jivana, RG equals registering consciousness, B equals bhavaga. 1. Past bhavaga, added a bhavaga, 1 bhavaga passes away, thus it is past bhavaga. 2. Vibrating bhavaga, bhavaga kalana, because of the impingement of the visible object, the bhavaga vibrates. PVARCFEIDJJJJJJJRGRGB. 3. Arrest bhavaga, bhavagupaketa, the bhavaga stream is cut off in order to give way to the cognitive process to apprehend the new sense object. The above three bhavaga siddhas are process-freed consciousness. 4. 5. Door adverting consciousness pa ca vorobhayana, the first cognitive process is now set up. It adverts the mind towards the sense or visible object, as if the mind is inquiring, what is this? It is functional consciousness. 5. Eye consciousness kaku vioa, it performs the function of seeing the visible object. It only sees the color, not the shape and form of the object yet. If the object is sound, ear consciousness arises hearing the sound, if it is taste, then tongue consciousness arises knowing the taste. The type of sense consciousness that arises depends on the corresponding sense object. As many billions of consciousness arise and vanish within the snap of a finger, we mistakenly think that we perceive a form as soon as we see it, that we know a sound as soon as we hear it, that we know the taste as soon as we taste it. Actually, at this point, the object is at its rudimentary stage, and is still not clear yet. The five types of sense consciousness: 1. Air resultant consciousness produced by previous kama. 6. Receiving consciousness, sampaichana, receives that visible object. It is resultant consciousness. 7. Investigating consciousness, santarawa, investigates that visible object. It is resultant consciousness. 8. Determining consciousness, vohihapana, determines the visible object. It is functional consciousness. These types of consciousness, 4-8, up to the determining consciousness, arise in spite of ourselves, and cannot be controlled. The resultant consciousness, namely seeing consciousness, receiving consciousness, and investigating consciousness, are the effects of actions, comma, performed in past lives. 9-15, 7 jivanas, jivana consciousness runs 7 times. These 7 are all the same kind of consciousness. They are either the same kind of wholesome consciousness rooted in non-greed, non-hatred, or non-delusion, or the same kind of unwholesome consciousness rooted in greed, hatred, or delusion, and they run 7 times swiftly over the object, in the act of apprehending it. Jivana literally means, running swiftly. It is at this stage that the object is fully experienced. The jivana stage is the most important from an ethical standpoint, since it is here that good or bad kama is. 1. Eye consciousness, ear consciousness, nose consciousness, tongue consciousness, and body consciousness. formatted, bullets and numbering. Originated or performed. Unlike the preceding consciousnesses, which are rootless, Jivana consciousness has either the unwholesome roots of greed, hatred, or delusion, or the wholesome roots of non-greed, non-hatred, or non-delusion, and these six roots are the underlying sources of motivation that bring forth karma. Just as a tree with roots is more stable and firm, consciousness at the Jivana stage is more stable, firm, and forceful compared with the rootless consciousness. Thus karma means all wholesome and unwholesome volitions, having the three evil roots or three moral roots. How we react towards the object mostly depends on our accumulated tendencies along the rounds of rebirth. If someone has accumulated a great deal of greed, consciousness rooted in greed is likely to arise when the object is pleasant. On the other hand, if someone has accumulated a great deal of hatred, consciousness rooted in hatred is likely to arise when the visible object is unpleasant. If we react in the same pattern all the time, its force is gradually reinforced and it will become our second nature, like a snowball that rolls down a snowy hill, getting bigger and bigger. Suppose you react carelessly or without mindfulness, taking delight in the visible object, then unwholesome consciousness rooted in greed arises 7 times. On the other hand, if you dislike or feel frustrated with the visible object, then unwholesome consciousness rooted in anger will arise and pass away 7 times. It means a moral karma is performed. Thus Jivana is very important, because it involves wholesome karma and unwholesome karma, which you have to pay for, when the result ripens. 16-17, registering consciousness Tadoramala, after 7 Jivanas, 2 registering consciousnesses arise and pass away, taking the same object as the Jivanas. Tadoramala literally means, having that object that had been apprehended by the Jivanas. Just as a man who is running fast has to slow down for a few steps before coming to a stop, registration arises twice following the Jivanas to slow down their force before the mind lapses back into the Bhavaga stream. At this point the cognitive process comes to an end, together with the perishing away of the visible object and eye sensitivity. When the lifespan of matter is complete, the eye-door cognitive process comes to an end. Such a cognitive process occurs when the object is very great, which means it has struck the mind with great intensity, and is called the course ending in registration. In eye-door cognitive process, except for eye consciousness, which arises depending on eye sensitivity, the rest of the consciousness arises depending on the heart base. The first consciousness to the third is process freed. The fourth consciousness up to the 17th belongs to the actual cognitive process. Sometimes when the object is not very prominent to the senses, the 2 moments of registering consciousness will not arise. The cognitive process then stops at the Jivana stage, and the mind lapses into Bhavaga again. When there is only a slight object, which means the impact of the object on the mind is not strong, the cognitive process stops at determining consciousness. And when the object is very slight, there is no cognitive process at all, only Bhavaga vibrates for a few moments. After the eye-door cognitive process, Bhavaga arises and ceases successively one after another until the mind-door cognitive process arises, in order to apprehend this visible object more clearly. It is a fixed law that Bhavagas must arise after each cognitive process. How many moments of Bhavagasata arise and pass away in between 2 cognitive processes depends on the stage of your mind development. The shorter it is, the better. It shows the alertness of your mind. Mind-door cognitive process. Mind-door cognitive process 1 chart 3. B. B-A-J-M-J-J-J-J-J-R-G-R-G. Wholesome or unwholesome karma is performed and strengthened at the Jivana stage. P. B equals vibrating Bhavaga, E equals arrest Bhavaga, M equals mind-door adverting consciousness, J equals Jivana, R-G equals registering consciousness, B equals Bhavaga. The mind-door cognitive process is slightly different from the 5-door cognitive P process. After an eye-door cognitive process, many Bhavaga siddhas arise, followed by a mind-door cognitive process, which takes the same visible object, that has already perished, as past object. In the mind-door cognitive process, first one Bhavaga vibrates, then another Bhavaga sitta is arrested, followed by mind-door adverting consciousness which adverts the mind to that past visible object. Immediately, Jivana consciousness arises 7 times to apprehend or cognize that past visible object. After 7 Jivanas, 2 moments of registering consciousness occur, then the mind-door cognitive process finishes, and the mind lapses into Bhavaga again. In the case of an obscure object, the 2 moments of registration do not occur. Many mind-door cognitive processes follow afterwards, in order to cognize clearly the color, name, form and shape of the visible object and the reaction towards it. The first mind-door cognitive process recognizes the past visible object, which has already perished with the five-door cognitive process. The second mind-door cognitive process recognizes the name of the visible object. The third mind-door cognitive process recognizes the shape or form of that visible object. In the following mind-door cognitive process, one begins to develop like or dislike towards the visible object, in which comma then is strongly performed. Starting from the fourth mind-door cognitive process, the comma performed is heavier than in the five-door cognitive process and the first to third mind-door thought processes. This is because when the object becomes clearer, the reaction to it also becomes stronger. Suppose one gets angry at the visible object. Consciousness rooted in anger will run for 7 times. Since many mind-door cognitive processes follow one after another, consciousness rooted in anger will arise in succession countless times, as mind arises and passes away at tremendous speed. With one snap of the fingers, thousands of billions of moments of consciousness arise. Then if one gets angry for 5 minutes, uncountable billions of unwholesome karma are produced and leave behind unwholesome karmic potency in the stream of consciousness. Similarly, if one reacts with jealousy, meanness and cruelty towards an object, the consciousness rooted in anger will arise continuously until you change your mental state. On the other hand, if one gets attached to a visible object, consciousness rooted in greed will arise successively in jivana stage countless times. Each jivana has potentiality to produce its result either in the present life or the lives hereafter. Uncountable billions of latent effects lay waiting to emerge when conditions permit. So be careful, as even small unwholesome acts multiply. As it says in the Dhammapada, do not think lightly of evil, saying, it will not come to me. Even a water pot is filled by the falling of drops. Likewise the fool, gathering it drop by drop, fills himself with evil. However, these unwholesome jivanas are not fixed, like resultant and functional consciousness. We are our own master. We can exercise control over our own mental states and change unwholesome jivanas into wholesome through wise attention, jnanasomanasikara. For example, when a man sees a beautiful girl, instead of giving rise to lustful thoughts, he can contemplate the impurities of the human body. How? He contemplates this body consists of skin, flesh, bones, blood, pus, feces, sweat, fats and so on. He changes his perception of beauty to the perception of repulsiveness, resulting in the lustful thoughts losing its enticement. In Sri Lanka, there was a monk called Tissa, who habitually practiced skeleton meditation and vipassana. One day while going for alms round, on the way he heard a woman's laughter and when he looked up, he saw her set of teeth. Then he quickly contemplated the skeleton externally, then internally and achieved the first jhana and proceeded to vipassana. A few minutes later, the husband searching for his wife, asked the monk if he had seen a beautiful woman passing by. His reply was he did not see a woman, only a skeleton. Thus, this is one of the ways to replace unarisen unwholesome thoughts to wholesome thoughts, through wise attention. When one meets with misery, fears, or unhappiness which is a part of life such as, loss of loved ones or wealth, ill-treatment, blamed or accused unjustly, divorce or sexually abused, cheated and defamed, and the suffering of bad health. Instead of lamentation and despair by beating one's heart, wailing away which is actually a sign of anger, one should try to recall the teachings of the Buddha by reflecting on, this is the result of my past unwholesome karma, and therefore, accept it with equanimity. As the Buddha said, I am the owner of my own karma, heir of my karma, born of my karma, related to my karma, abide supported by my karma, whatever karma I shall do, whether good or bad, of that I shall be the heir. Reflecting thus, one not only alleviates one's suffering and anger by skillful wise attention, but is also able to leave behind good mental karma, based on right view of kamasakata, that all beings are the owners of their own karma. To see whatever happens as they really are as impermanent, suffering and as a manifestation of cause and effect, is also helpful to change unwholesome jivanas into wholesome jivanas. If we make a habit to always respond with generosity, loving-kindness, patience, honesty and compassion towards the object, supposing beings are the object, then wholesome consciousness rooted in non-greed, non-hatred and non-delusion, will arise successively in calculable times, leaving behind beautiful karmic potency in one stream of consciousness. When that karma produces its result in future life, one will be reborn in a wealthy family and has a kind temperament, karita, full of loving kindness, beautiful appearance, straightforwardness and loved by many. If one has the ability to penetrate the nature of the visible object as impermanence, suffering and non-self with vipassana knowledge, many mind-door cognitive processes associated with vipassana knowledge will arise successively uncountable times, leaving behind powerful karmic potency in the stream of consciousness. When the result ripens and produces rebirth consciousness in future lives, one will become a person endowed with sharp wisdom. If one practices vipassana meditation in that life easily and swiftly, one will realize nibbana. Thus, it is said in the Dhammapada, "Do not think lightly of good," saying, "It will not come to me." Even a water pot is filled by the falling of drops, so the wise man, gathering it drop by drop, fills himself with good. At the sense sphere jivana stage, kama or action may be performed by body, speech, or thought. The unwholesome bodily actions are 1. Killing living beings, given to blows and violence, merciless to living beings. 2. Taking what is not given, taking by way of theft the wealth and property of others. 3. Sexual misconduct, misconducting oneself in sexual pleasures, having intercourse with such women as are protected by their mother, father, sisters, brothers or relatives, who has a husband and who are protected by law. The wholesome bodily actions are abstaining from committing these three. The unwholesome verbal actions are 1. Telling lies, speaking falsehood for one's own good or for another's good. 2. Slander, speaking maliciously, repeats elsewhere what has been heard, in order to divide people, or vice versa. 3. Harsh speech, uttering words which are rough, hard, hurtful or offensive to others. 4. Frivolous talk, speaking at the wrong time, speaks what is not fact, what is useless, speaks contrary to the truth or Dhamma, speaks words which are worthless, unreasonable, immoderate and unbeneficial. Abstaining from these four is wholesome verbal action. The unwholesome mental actions are 1. Covetousness, the mental factor of greed, arisen with the wish to acquire another person's property. 2. Ill will, the mental factor of hatred, arising with the wish that another being meets with harm and affliction. 3. Wrong view, denies that there is becoming after death, the nihilistic view, and denies the working of karma. The opposite states of non-covetousness, non-ill will, and right view are wholesome mental actions. The wholesome or unwholesome jivanas, generated in the five-door cognitive process, only produce their result within lifetimes pavati, and cannot produce any mind and matter or five aggregates at the rebirth consciousness moment, because the object is still rudimentary. But the jivanas, starting from the fourth mind-door cognitive process onward, are powerful enough to produce mind and matter, at the rebirth consciousness moment etc., in future lives, as well as the present life. This is how the five-door cognitive process and mind-door cognitive processes arise and pass away, in order to apprehend the five sense objects and generate karma. Sometimes the cognitive process occurs exclusively through the mind-door, without depending on the sense doors. When any of the six objects enters the range of cognition entirely on its own, and not as a continuation of one of the five sense door processes, it is called a bare mind-door process, Sutta-Manabhora-Bhati. For example, when one engages in thinking, imagining or recollecting past experiences etc. Mind-door cognitive process 2 chart 4. BAJMJJJJJJRGRGB. First jivana generates immediately effective kama, second through sixth jivana, seventh jivana generates which can only produce its generate indefinitely effective subsequently effective kama, effect in this very life. Kama, which can produce its result in the effect at any time along sa time sora, immediate future life. Until one reaches parinibbana. Ki, B equals vibrating bhavaga, E equals arrest bhavaga, M equals mind door adverting consciousness, J equals jivana, RG equals registering consciousness, B equals bhavaga. As stated above, the seven jivanas in the mind door cognitive process are the same consciousness occurring seven times. The first jivana is the weakest one, because of lack of repetition prior to it, and it generates immediately effective kama, dhyanamavedaniya, which can produce its result in the present life only. At the time of the Buddha, a daughter of a garland maker whose name was Maliko offered all her food with great joy to the Buddha, when she saw the exalted one coming to obtain alms. Because of this wholesome kama, she became the queen of Kosala the very same day. This kama, which was generated by the first jivana, produced its effect in this very life, in the same continuity of mind and matter. If it cannot produce its result in this very life because of the missing necessary causes and conditions for the resultant to take place, it becomes defunct kama, ahosi kama. The seventh or last Javana is the second weakest because the force has faded. However, with the reinforcement of repetition by the previous six Javanas, this seventh Javana is able to generate subsequently effective Kama, Apapajavedaniya, which can produce its result in the immediate future life if it meets with the right conditions. If it cannot produce its result in the immediate future life, it becomes defunct Kama. At the time of the Buddha, King Ajoetasattu, persuaded by Devadatta, killed his father King Bimbisara. Due to this heavy Kama, after his own death, King Ajoetasattu was cast into hell. This Kama, which was generated by the seventh Javana, produced his rebirth consciousness in hell, immediately after death. At Paok Forest Meditation Center, one of the meditators traced back to the Kama he had done in his past life to produce his present life as a human being. He saw with his insight knowledge that in the immediate past life he was an elephant, offering lotus flower to the pagoda. At the time of his offering, many wholesome Javanas in the mind door cognitive processes arose and passed away successively. Only one of the seventh Javanas generated subsequently effective Kama, which produced his rebirth consciousness as a human being in the immediate future life, which is the present life. The second Javana up to the sixth Javana are the most powerful, owing to the reinforcement of repeated ion by preceding Javanas. They generate indefinitely effective Kama, Aparaparyavedaniya, which can produce its result from the second future life onward, whenever the conditions are fulfilled. It may produce the five aggregates or mind and matter at the rebirth linking moment, in some far future lives. As long as this Kama does not give its result, its force underlies the mind and matter continuity. As long as the round of rebirths goes on, it never becomes defunct. Not even a Buddha or an Arahant is free from experiencing the result of it. It becomes defunct only at one's final Nibbana. For example, Venerable Moggallona, who was the left-hand chief disciple of the Buddha and foremost in psychic power, during one of his past lives beat his blind parents almost to death. Because of that heavy unwholesome Kama, immediately after death, he was reborn in hell and suffered for millions of years. When he came out from hell, he was reborn as a human being for 200 successive lifetimes, with each lifetime ended with his skull being crushed and dying as a result. At his last birth, when a gang of bandits approached him, he was able to escape many times using his psychic powers, but finally, due to the ripening of his past unwholesome Kama, he lost his psychic powers and was unable to escape. The bandits entered, knocked him down, and pounded his bones until they were as small as grains of rice. But he was not dead. He resumed his psychic powers, and appearing before the Buddha, he paid his last respect, then using his psychic power he went back to Kolasi 1/4a, and entered into final Nibbana Parinibbana. Only with his Parinibbana did his previously accumulated Kama become defunct. How fearsome and dreadful is the result of unwholesome Kama. One should try to understand and avoid committing any evil Kama, which brings about painful consequences, hard to endure. In another story, during the Buddha's time, a monk named Kakupola became an Arahant, but afterwards became blind. Some people asked the Buddha the cause of his blindness. The Buddha told them that in a past life this monk had been a physician. A woman asked him to restore her eyesight, promising that if he could restore it, she and her children would become his servants. His remedy restored her eyesight, but the woman, unwilling to keep her promise, told him it was getting worse. Prompted by anger, in an act of cruelty, he gave her a remedy that really blinded her. Due to that evil action, for many lifetimes, he lost his eyesight, even in his last life, after becoming an Arahant. 1. This is how the second to the sixth Javanas generate indefinitely effective Kama along Sasara until the attainment of one's Parinibbana. Thus it is vital to know one's own defilements are one's own greatest enemy. Unable to subdue one's greed, anger and delusion, one commit unwholesome deeds accordingly that leave behind painful results. One becomes the true conqueror only when one conquers one's defilements. You may wonder why an action that is performed only once does not simply produce its effect only once but does so even for incalculable lifetimes. This is because of the repetition and reinforcement of thousands of billions of Javana moments. Each Javana moment leaves behind its karmic force. Therefore, to understand the workings of Kama, it is necessary to understand the workings of the mind. As the Buddha said in the Dhammapada, mind is the forerunner of all evil states. Mind is chief, mind made are they. If one speaks or acts with wicked mind, because of that, suffering follows one, even as the wheel follows the hoof of the ox. If one speaks or acts with pure mind, because of that, happiness follows one, even as one's shadow that never leaves. Due to the diversity of consciousness, a diversity of karma and its results are experienced by beings. Bad karma is something to be frightened of. Do not think lightly of evil, even if one performs the bad action only once, it is able to. One Dhammapada commentary. Produce its effect countless times along the round of rebirths, sa times sora. Consequently, one has to undergo painful results. The Buddha said in the Dhammapada, mind delights in evil. Just as it is natural for water to flow from mountains down to lower places, so also the mind's tendency is to go to the evil side. If we do not want to undergo painful results, we have to try our best to prevent evil minds such as anger, craving, jealousy, conceit, avarice, selfishness, cruelty, etc. from arising and cultivate more good minds such as faith, shame of wrongdoing, generosity, kindness, appreciative joy, compassion, patience, tolerance, wisdom, etc. Having good mental states not only enable us to abide in comfort and happiness in our lifetimes before the cycle of birth and death comes to an end, but also to provide trust, safety, protection and love to others. This involves right effort. Right effort is fourfold, namely to prevent, discard, develop, and maintain. Fourfold right effort. 1. The effort to prevent the arising of unarisen evil. Unarisen evil includes killing, taking what is not given, sexual misconduct, false speech, taking intoxicants, etc. One prevents the arising of unarisen evil by observing the five training rules, which are to abstain from the aforementioned evil actions, and by guarding the five sense doors, since evil or unprofitable thoughts enter through these five sense doors. In Saloyatana Bhaga, in Sa times Yuta Nikoyaya, the simile of the tortoise, advises how to avoid evil by guarding one's sense doors. The tortoise was searching for food along the bank of a river one evening. On that same evening, a jackal was also searching for food at the same place. When the tortoise saw the jackal in the distance searching for food, it drew its limbs and neck inside its shell and passed the time keeping still and silent. The jackal had also seen the tortoise, so he approached and waited close by thinking, when this tortoise extends one or another of its limbs or its neck, I will grab it right on the spot, pull it out, and eat it. However, the tortoise did not extend any of its limbs or its neck. The jackal, failing to gain access to it, lost interest and departed. Defilements are constantly and continually waiting close by to try to gain access to us through the unguarded five sense doors. If we leave the mind faculty unguarded, evil unwholesome states of covetousness and displeasure might invade us. How can we guard our sense doors? By fixing the mind on the meditation object either through practicing concentration meditation or insight meditation. When the mind absorbs in the object of meditation, the five sense doors are closed, and the unarisen evil will not have a chance to arise from unwise attention. Instead, wholesome consciousness will arise successively and leave behind an incalculable wholesome karmic force in the mental stream. 2. The effort to discard evil that has already arisen. Buddha gave five ways to remove evil thoughts that has already arisen, in Majjhima Nikoyaya, in the Vidikasantheno Sutta, the discourse on the removal of distracting thoughts. When evil, unwholesome thought connected with desire, hate, and delusion arise, one should give attention to the opposite mental state connected with the wholesome. Such as when thoughts of sensual desire arise directed towards the opposite sex, one should meditate on foulness of the body by contemplating on the impurity or repulsiveness of the 32 parts of that person's body. The human body is made up of 32 parts, such as head hairs, body hairs, nails, teeth, skin, flesh, sinews, bones, bone marrow, kidneys, heart, liver, membrane, spleen, lungs, intestines, mesentery, gorge, feces, brain, bile, phlegm, pus, blood, sweat, fat, tears, grease, saliva, nasal discharge, synovial fluid, and urine. As one keeps on contemplating these 32 parts one by one as repulsive, gradually a strong sense of repulsiveness will arise in one, and easily one will let go of clinging to the body of that opposite sex. If one continues to contemplate the repulsiveness of one's 32 parts, one will remove thoughts of attachment towards one's own body. When greed arises towards inanimate objects, one can contemplate the impermanence of those objects. Even the waters of the great ocean gradually dry up, great as it is seen to be impermanent, subject to destruction and change. What of these objects, last but for a while? Thus, one removes the clinging and possessiveness to them. When thoughts of hate arise directed towards living beings, one can replace anger with loving kindness by wishing them to be well and happy, free from any mental and physical suffering. Two mind moments cannot arise at the same time. When the mind is busy engaging in pervading loving kindness, anger finds no opportunity to creep in. But if this proved to be difficult to somebody who has no mastery over his mind, Visuddhimagga, the path of purification, provides many different alternatives. As outlined in the Visuddhimagga, it is good to strive and make effort to subside one's resentment. If this is not possible, then the irritation may be removed by remembering some good of the person, so as to generate the confidence in him again. Everyone has some good qualities. One person may be well behaved but not with his speech in mind. Then his good quality should be remembered and the bad ones ignored. Or if one can recall the good deeds he may have done for us previously, these can soften our heart. There may be another whose actions, speech, and mind are not restrained. Then we should arouse compassion for that person. Though he is going about and living happily in the human world now, in a matter of time, he will find himself in misery, blamed by the public, punished by the government, and may even fall into one of the four woeful states due to his unwholesome deeds. Compassion makes the hearts of the good person quiver when they see others afflicted with sorrow. Irritation subsides too through compassion. But if one still finds thoughts of resentment arising, then one should reflect on the special qualities of the Buddha's former conduct when he was a Bodhisattva. In the Kantivote Squared Birth story, the Bodhisattva was asked by the ignorant king of Kasi, Benares, "What do you preach, monk?" And the Bodhisattva replied, "I am a preacher of patience, and when the king had his hands and feet cut off, he felt not the slightest anger. He remained loving and cherishing the king still, wishing him a happy, long life." If after reflecting on the Buddha's former conduct, resentment has not subsided, one should try to consider that we are all related. As the Buddha said, "Bhikkhus, it is not easy to find a being who has not formerly been your mother, your father, your brother, your sister, your son, your daughter. If that is the case, how can we allow anger to reside in our hearts for those who were our relatives? Yet, if we still fail to end the resentment, we should then try resolution into elements. How? When you are angry with someone, what is it you are angry with? The body is the combination of 32 parts. Is it the person's head hairs you are angry with? Or body hairs? Or bones? Or is it urine you are angry with? Or alternatively, is it the earth element you are angry with, or the water element, or the fire element, or the wind element? Or which of the five aggregates with respect to this person you are angry with? Is it the materiality aggregate, the feeling aggregate, the perception aggregate, the formations aggregate, or the consciousness aggregate? For when one tries the resolution into elements, one's anger finds no foothold, like a painting on the air. But if one cannot practice the resolution of the elements, one should reproach oneself thus: by getting angry you're like a man who wants to hit another and picks up a burning ember or excrement and so first burned yourself or made yourself stink. Oh, aren't you a foolish person? If one still finds resentment arising, one should try the giving of a gift to show our big-heartedness and forgiveness. Forgiveness is the most tender part of the heart of a good person. This might soften his heart. And even anger that has been dogging him from a past birth subsides at the moment. Both of you might even become good friends. Another constructive way of ending one's resentment or anger was clearly presented by Venerable Sariputta. In his well-known discourse of Mahoyhathapadopama Sutta, in the Majjhima Nikaya, the great discourse on the simile of the elephant's footprint, Venerable Sariputta urges us to contemplate the impermanence of painful feeling when one is abused or reviled. He sees that painful feeling is dependent, not independent. Dependent on what? Dependent on contact. Then he sees that contact is impermanent, that feeling is impermanent, that perception is impermanent, those formations are impermanent, and that consciousness is impermanent. Thus he is able to turn his painful feeling into spiritual growth. When one wins over one's defilements after a long struggle, one finds great joy and satisfaction. If one fails using the first method and there still arise unwholesome thoughts connected with desire, hatred, and delusion, one should examine the danger in these thoughts. Thus, these thoughts are unwholesome, they are reprehensible, productive of painful results for uncountable lifetimes according to the law of karma. Having thus reflected, if unwholesome thoughts still arise, one should try to forget these thoughts and should not give attention to them, just like when a person does not want to see something, they close their eyes or avert their attention to other things. IV, if while trying to forget, unwholesome thoughts still arise, one should inquire into the cause of those unwholesome thoughts. As one keeps on inquiring, the flow of unwholesome thoughts slackens and eventually ceases. B, if after inquiring into the causes, unwholesome thoughts still arise, then with teeth clenched and the tongue pressed against the roof of the mouth, one should be down, constrain, and crush the unwholesome mind with the wholesome mind. The practice of the teaching of the Buddha is a battle within. Only one's own greed, anger, and delusion are one's enemy. Said by the Buddha, whatever harm an enemy may do to his enemy, a wrongly directed mind can do far greater harm. If you can conquer your own greed, hatred, conceit, jealousy, stinginess, worry, delusion, and cruelty, who else can bring you harm? One will remain unshaken in any circumstances. This is freedom of the heart. 3. The effort to arouse unarisen wholesome states. Unarisen wholesome states include attending to parents and elders, observing the 5 or 8 precepts, giving and sharing what one has with others, practicing meditation and so on. If one has not yet undertaken especially the threefold training in morality, concentration and wisdom, one should arouse the effort to do so, together with the understanding of the great benefit arising from them. 4. The effort to develop and bring to perfection the wholesome states that have already arisen. One should continue to practice with great perseverance the threefold training until one achieves arahantship, the deathless state where all the mental corruptions are destroyed forever. One small bad action will produce countless effects. Similarly, a good action 1 hectare deep performed would produce countless good effects in the future, whenever the opportunities ripen, just like a smart investor who, though investing just a small amount of money, can eventually reap a fortune. One reaps what one sows. What we have reaped today reflects what we have sown in the past. If we wish our future to be full of hopes and happiness, we should diligently guard our actions in the present moment. An excellent example is of the Bodhisattva. For many lifetimes, because of his generosity, doina, and morality, sila, in the past, the Bodhisattva was reborn as a wise king, a prince, or millionaire's son. He had reaped what he had sown. At the time of the Buddha Annamadisi, human beings lived up to 100,000 years. There lived a poor man who offered his labor for hire. He diligently observed the 5 precepts with great care, for nearly 100,000 years without breaking them. After his death, owing to his unblemished virtue, he traversed among devas and human realms happily, up to the time of the Gautama Buddha. In all these subsequent lives, he was endowed with these 3 qualities, long life, handsome appearance and sharp wisdom. At the time of the Gautama Buddha, when he was 5 years old, he followed his parents to the temple. Upon receiving instruction from the monk on the practice of the observance of the 5 precepts, he swiftly recollected the morality he had undertaken in the long past. While listening to the monk preach the 4 noble truths, his insight knowledge became mature and he easily attained arahantship. The karma returns itself in a spectacular, mind-boggling, fair and soothing way. Generosity, morality and concentration are important factors, as lacking these 3, would be extremely difficult for one to get the opportunity to meet the next dispensation of the Buddha. Not meeting the dispensation of the Buddha, one is devoid of the opportunity to listen to the Dhamma, which is the essential factor for the attainment of stream enterer. These are also the supporting factors for one to practice Samatha and Vipassana meditation without much obstruction. Unless one is assured of the attainment of arahantship in this life, one must perform generosity and keep one's morality to ensure the conducive conditions for one's practice in the future. 6 types of consciousness. Although consciousness has the single characteristic of awareness of an object, it is divided into 6 classes. 1. Consciousness of sight. 2. Consciousness of sound. 3. Consciousness of smell. 4. Consciousness of taste. 5. Consciousness of touch. 6. Consciousness of mental object or Dhamma object. 1. The consciousness arising dependent on the eye sensitivity coming into contact with a visible object is called the consciousness of sight and has the function of seeing. It merely sees the color but does not understand white or red, etc. It also does not see the shape and form, which can only be understood by the mind or cognitive process. 2. The consciousness arising dependent on the ear sensitivity is called the consciousness of sound and has the function of hearing. It merely hears the sound but does not know the meaning of the sound. To understand the meaning of sound is the work of mind or cognitive process. 3. The consciousness arising dependent on the nose sensitivity is called the consciousness of smell and has the function of smelling. It merely smells the smell, but does not know what type of smell. To know the type of smell is the work of mind-door cognitive process. 4. The consciousness arising dependent on the tongue sensitivity is called the consciousness of taste, and has the function of tasting. It merely tastes the taste, but does not know whether it is bitter, sour, or sweet. To know the type of taste is the work of mind-door cognitive process. 5. The consciousness arising dependent on the body sensitivity is called the consciousness of touch, and has the function of touching. It merely knows the tangible object, but cannot distinguish whether it is soft, hard, or cold, which is the work of mind-door cognitive process. Body sensitivity is located all over the body, except at the tip of the nails, hair and dead skin. 6. The consciousness arising dependent on the heart base, when coming into contact with one of the aforementioned 5 sense objects or mental objects, 1. Mental objects include, 1. The 5 sensitive phenomena, 2. 16 subtle matter, 3. Consciousness, 4. 52 mental factors, 5. Nibbana, 6. Concepts like house, mountain, kasyoa, inopina, nimitta, etc. It is called consciousness of mental objects. Apart from the 5 types of sense consciousness, all consciousness arises dependent on the heart base. In the immaterial plane, however, mind consciousness arises without any base. Thus consciousness takes 6 types of objects, visible objects, sounds, smells, tastes, tangible objects and mental objects. No consciousness will arise without taking an object. Consciousness is not oneself. Subconsciousness arises, performs its own function, and then perishes, becoming the condition for the next consciousness to arise, all at tremendous speed. In the time it takes for one blink of the eye, thousands of billions of moments of consciousness arise and cease. It is not appropriate to rely on them, as things having substance, as well as not to regard them as the essence or substance of oneself. They are non-self, anatta. As preached by the Lord Buddha in the Discourse on the Characteristic of Non-Self, Anadilakana Sutta, if consciousness were self, then this consciousness would not lead to affliction, for we could say of consciousness, let consciousness be thus, or let consciousness not be thus. It is because consciousness is not self that it leads to affliction. The arising and ceasing of consciousness does not yield to one's wishes. That mere carrying out of functions also should not be delusively considered a permanent self, since every ultimate reality has its own function to perform. The momentary arising and cessation of consciousness is necessarily marked by impermanence, anicca, that which is born must undergo change, and this oppression by rise and fall is necessarily unsatisfactory, painful and difficult to endure, dukkha. That which is impermanent, painful, subject to change, can it rightly be regarded as this is mine, bound up with craving, this is what I am, bound up with conceit, this is myself, bound up with wrong view? No, they cannot. The occurrence and continuity of consciousness depends on various causes and conditions. For example, for eye consciousness to arise, the visible object, eye sensitivity, light, eye contact, and attention, adverting consciousness, are necessary. If the visible object does not impinge the eye sensitivity, eye consciousness cannot arise. If there is a visible object and eye sensitivity, but it is dark, eye consciousness cannot take place. Even if there is a visible object, eye sensitivity, and light, but one does not pay attention to the visible object, eye consciousness cannot take place. Similarly, for ear consciousness to arise, the sound, ear sensitivity, space, ear contact, and attention, adverting consciousness, are necessary. If the sound does not impinge the ear sensitivity, ear consciousness cannot arise. If there is a sound and ear sensitivity, but if it is blocked by a wall, ear consciousness cannot take place. Even if there is a sound, ear sensitivity in space, but one does not pay attention to the sound, ear consciousness cannot take place. So, besides the coming together of causes and conditions, there is nothing we could call a self or soul, who exercises control over the whole process. It is non-self, anatta. Unable to break down the compactness of the continuity, santiti gana, of consciousness that is dependent upon causes and conditions, we think it is just one consciousness, or the same consciousness performing the act of seeing, hearing, tasting, thinking, and so on. Thus, one develops the wrong view of self. Consciousness that arises, depending on visible object and eye sensitivity, is reckoned as eye consciousness. Consciousness that arises, depending on sound and ear sensitivity, is reckoned as ear consciousness. Consciousness that arises depending on smell and nose sensitivity is reckoned as nose consciousness, etc. Eye consciousness ceases when its conditions are removed without transmigrating to ear consciousness or nose consciousness. Situd is ear consciousness ceases when the conditions for its arising cease without transmigrating to nose conscio us ness or tongue consciousness. To say the same consciousness performs the act of seeing, then transmigrating to hearing, smelling, tasting is none other than wrong view. Consciousness cannot arise alone. It is always associated with certain mental factors. Each mental factor performs its specific function to assist consciousness in the total act of cognition. For example, the associated mental factor of feeling performs the function of enjoying or experiencing the taste of objects. The mental factor of perception performs the function of making a mark of objects as a condition for subsequently recognizing it as being the same. The mental factor of attention adverts or directs the mind to the object. Because we cannot break down the compactness of the function, kikagana, of mental factors, we think it is the same, I performing the function of experiencing the object, perceiving the object, and directing or fixing on the object. Or we identify the mental factors of conceit, mindfulness, greed, anger, avarice, restlessness, etc. As, I, myself, a person, a being, she, he, are as one's own, or as if one is the overlord of these phenomena. Thus, one wrongly develops perception of self. One's perception of self is wrongly grasped, it establishes itself very firmly, and subsequently, the person has to exert great effort to remove this wrong view. How can one break down these two types of compactness, compactness of the continuity and compactness of function, and penetrate into their true nature as they really are? It is only through the development of wisdom based on concentration. As the Buddha said, one who has deep concentration sees things as they really are. When each mind moment is examined with concentration and wisdom, one realizes that apart from the combination of consciousness and mental factors with their own special characteristics and functions, there is no substance one can grasp which can be called I or I am. It is mere phenomena flowing. If one can see these phenomena as they really are, one's vision is called correct vision. At Pahok Meditation Center, meditators are taught Vipassana meditation based on jhana concentration or access concentration. At a certain stage of their practice, the mediator is able to discern the different cognitive processes and the momentary arising and passing away of each consciousness. At that moment, one breaks down the compactness of continuity. When one is able to discern the characteristic, function, manifestation, and proximate cause of consciousness and its associated mental factors, one breaks down the compactness of function. At that time, the knowledge of non-self dawns on the meditator vividly. B. Consciousness can also be classified into four groups by way of sphere or plane. 1. Sense sphere consciousness Kayomo Vikarasiddha. 2. Fine material sphere consciousness Ripoe Vikarasiddha. 3. Immaterial sphere consciousness Arapoe Vikarasiddha. 4. Supramundane consciousness Lokutarasiddha. 31. Planes of existence Chart 5. Realm of neither perception or non-perception. Realm of nothingness, four immaterial sphere planes, realm of infinite consciousness, realm of infinite space, seven planes of fourth jhana, three planes of third jhana, 16 fine material, three planes of second jhana, sphere planes, three planes of first jhana, six deva realms, seven sensuous, one human realm, blissful planes, one asura realm, 11 sense, one pita realm, four woeful sphere, one animal realm, planes, planes, one hell beings realm. 1. Sense sphere consciousness prevails in the 11 sensuous planes, 6 deva realms, 1 human realm, 4 woeful realms of asura, pita, animals and hell beings. In this sphere, craving for sense pleasures such as pleasant visible objects, sound, smell, taste and tangible object predominates. These include 12 unwholesome consciousness, 8 wholesome consciousness, resultant consciousness and functional consciousness. 2. Fine material sphere consciousness. This sphere of consciousness includes all the siddhas which frequent or pertain to the fine material plane of existence, rupabhumi, the realms in which gross matter is absent and only a subtle residue of matter remains. It is absorption or jhana consciousness, achieved through the development of concentration like mindfulness of breathing, 10 kasyo is 1, the four sublime abidings, brahmavihara 2, etc. It is 1. Earth, water, fire, wind, brown, red, yellow, white, light and space kasyo is. These 10 kasyoas are the prerequisites for developing supernatural power. 2. Loving kindness, compassion, appreciative joy and equanimity. Free from craving for sensual pleasure, the five hindrances 1. That obstruct mental development having been suppressed. There are altogether 15 types of fine material sphere consciousness. They are five wholesome fine material sphere consciousness, five resultant fine material sphere consciousness, and five functional fine material sphere consciousness. Five wholesome fine material sphere consciousness. The five types of wholesome fine material sphere consciousness are 1. First jhana wholesome consciousness together with initial application. Sustained application, joy, happiness, and one-pointedness. 2. Second jhana wholesome consciousness together with sustained application, joy, happiness, and one-pointedness. 2. 3. Third jhana wholesome consciousness together with joy, happiness, and one-pointedness. 4. Fourth jhana wholesome consciousness together with happiness and one-pointedness. 5. Fifth jhana wholesome consciousness together with equanimity and one-pointedness. These five fine material sphere consciousness is distinguished by way of jhana factors. The five types of wholesome fine material sphere consciousness may arise in the mental stream of human, devas and brahmas when they engage in jhana practice. If they are able to maintain their jhana up to the dying moment, as a result of their wholesome karma, they will be reborn in one of the planes of fine material sphere corresponding to the jhana they have attained. Thus the five types of fine material sphere resultant consciousness are found in the fine material planes only, as rebirth consciousness bhavaga, and death consciousness for brahmas living there. Being the resultant consciousness of fine material jhana, they cannot arise in the sense sphere planes and immaterial sphere planes. B. Five resultant fine material sphere consciousness. The five types of fine material sphere resultant consciousness are 1. First jhana resultant consciousness together with initial application, sustained application, joy, happiness and one-pointedness. 1. Sensual desire, ill will, sloth and torpor, restlessness, remorse and doubt. 2. The first jhana and second jhana in Anhedama are equal to first jhana in Suddhanta. 2. Second jhana resultant consciousness together with sustained application, joy, happiness and one-pointedness. 3. Third jhana resultant consciousness together with joy, happiness, and one-pointedness. 4. Fourth jhana resultant consciousness together with happiness and one-pointedness. 5. Fifth jhana resultant consciousness together with equanimity and one-pointedness. C. 5. Functional fine material sphere consciousness. The five types of fine material sphere functional consciousness are experienced only by arahants who possess the five fine material jhana 1. These five functional consciousness are incapable of producing their result. They are 1. First jhana functional consciousness together with initial application. Sustained application, joy, happiness, and one-pointedness. 2. Second jhana functional consciousness together with sustained application, joy, happiness, and one-pointedness. 3. Third jhana functional consciousness together with joy, happiness, and one-pointedness. 4. Fourth jhana functional consciousness together with happiness and one-pointedness. 5. Fifth jhana functional consciousness together with equanimity and one-pointedness. 3. Immaterial sphere consciousness. This sphere of consciousness comprises the siddhas pertaining to the four immaterial plane of existence, Arapabhumi, in which matter has been totally transcended and only consciousness and mental factors remain. Rebirth into these four realms comes about through the attainment of the Arapajainas, the four immaterial absorptions, which are reached by developing concentration beyond the five jhana of the fine material sphere. This consciousness has become free from sense pleasures and from the desire for the fine material planes. The meditator, having achieved the fifth jhana with each of the kasyavas, reflects upon the disadvantages of materiality. He reflects that the body is subject to assault with weapons and by many different kinds of diseases such as eye disease, ear disease, and heart disease. Having thus reflected, the meditator becomes dispassionate towards materiality and develops the desire for immaterial jhana. Then he expands his kasyava nimitta, for example the earth kasyava, for as long as he wishes, and then removes the kasyava materiality by concentrating on the 1. Not every arahant possesses jhana. Some attain arahantship through dry insight without basing on jhana, vipassana yonika. Space in between the kasyava materiality and mentally noting, space, space. Then with the disappearing of the earth kasyava, what remains is the space. By concentrating repeatedly on that space, he reaches the immaterial jhana called the base of infinite space. At that time, his mental stream is occupied with the wholesome consciousness pertaining to the base of infinite space. To proceed to the second immaterial jhana called the base of infinite consciousness, the meditator reflects on the peaceful nature of the base of infinite consciousness. He takes as object the consciousness that was present during the attainment of the base of infinite space, and notes it as infinite consciousness, infinite consciousness. By repeatedly concentrating on it, he reaches the second immaterial jhana called the base of infinite consciousness. At that time, his mental stream is occupied with the wholesome consciousness pertaining to the base of infinite consciousness. Then he proceeds to the third immaterial jhana called the base of nothingness. When the base of infinite jhana consciousness is present, the base of infinite space jhana consciousness is absent. Two moments of consciousness cannot arise in one mind moment. Taking the absence of the base of infinite space jhana consciousness as object, he notes it as nothingness, nothingness. By a repeated attention to that nothingness, he reaches the third immaterial jhana called the base of nothingness. At that time, his mental stream is occupied with the wholesome consciousness pertaining to the base of nothingness. To proceed to the fourth immaterial jhana called the base of neither perception nor non-perception, he takes the base of nothingness consciousness as object. He concentrates on it as peaceful, peaceful. By a repeated attention to that again, he reaches the fourth immaterial jhana called the base of neither perception nor non-perception. At that time, his mental stream is occupied with the wholesome consciousness pertaining to the base of neither perception nor non-perception. There are altogether 12 types of immaterial sphere consciousness, 4 wholesome immaterial sphere consciousness, 4 resultant immaterial sphere consciousness, and 4 functional immaterial sphere consciousness. They differ from the material jhana as each of them has 2 jhana factors, namely one-pointedness and equanimity. 4 wholesome immaterial sphere consciousness. The 4 types of immaterial sphere wholesome consciousness are 1. Wholesome consciousness pertaining to the base of infinite space. Ikosainakoyadanakusalasita. 2. Wholesome consciousness pertaining to the base of infinite consciousness Vioakoyadanakusalasita. 3. Wholesome consciousness pertaining to the base of nothingness. Ikaicaoyatanakusalasita. 4. Wholesome consciousness pertaining to the base of neither perception or non-perception, Nevasa-oen-oesa-oyatanakusalasita. These 4 immaterial sphere wholesome consciousness arise in the mental stream of human, devas and brahmas when they engage in immaterial jhana practice. When they are able to enter the immaterial jhana, say the base of infinite space at their dying moment, they will be reborn in the realm of infinite space in their subsequent rebirth. Their rebirth consciousness, bhavaga, and death consciousness being the result of their wholesome karma of the immaterial jhana, is called the resultant consciousness pertaining to the infinite space. B. 4 resultant immaterial sphere consciousness. The 4 types of immaterial sphere resultant consciousness arise only in the 4 immaterial sphere planes corresponding to the immaterial jhana they have attained prior to death in their previous life. They arise as rebirth consciousness, bhavaga, and death consciousness for the Brahma beings there. They are 1. Resultant consciousness pertaining to the base of infinite space. Ikosainakoyadanavipokasita. 2. Resultant consciousness pertaining to the base of infinite consciousness. Vioakoyatanavipokasita. 3. Resultant consciousness pertaining to the base of nothingness. Ikaicaoyatanavipokasita. 4. Resultant consciousness pertaining to the base of neither perception nor non-perception, Nevasa-oen-oesa-oyatanavipokasita. C. 4 functional immaterial sphere consciousness. The 4 types of immaterial sphere functional consciousness are experienced only by arahants who possess the 4 immaterial jhana. They are 1. Functional consciousness pertaining to the base of infinite space. Ikosainakoyatanakriyoasita. 2. Functional consciousness pertaining to the base of infinite consciousness. Vioakoyatanakriyoasita. 3. Functional consciousness pertaining to the base of nothingness. Ikaicaoyatanakriyoasita. 4. Functional consciousness pertaining to the base of neither perception nor non-perception, Nevasa-oen-oesa-oyatanakriyoasita. 4. Supramundane consciousness is the noble consciousness, Ariyasata, that has gone beyond the 5 aggregates of clinging. This type of consciousness leads to liberation from Samikrosora, the cycle of births and deaths, and to the attainment of Nibbana, the cessation of suffering. It is of 2 kinds, the 4 types of wholesome path consciousness of stream entry, once returning, non-returning, and arahantship, and the 4 corresponding types of resultant fruition consciousness, which are their results. Both supramundane path consciousness and FRU vision consciousness take Nibbana as their object. Conclusion. Having analyzed consciousness by way of nature, planes of existence, and the way it occurs according to cognitive processes, one comes to understand the true significance of the importance of consciousness that operates incessantly in our life. This understanding unravels the mystery of cause and effect that lie behind our mental state, consciousness, and mental factors, which affect not only our past, present, and future lives, but from every moment to moment, as long as we remain in cycle of births and deaths. This leads to the second ultimate reality, mental factors. Ch.3, mental factors, CETASIKA. Consciousness cannot arise alone, but must arise accompanied by or associated with mental factors, which are the second ultimate reality. Mental factors cannot arise segregated from consciousness. The relationship between them is association relation, Sampayata Pakkheyo, according to the Pahona, the method of conditional relations. Although both function interdependently, consciousness is to be the forerunner of the mental factors because mental factors assist in the cognition of the object depending upon consciousness. The combination of both is called mind, noma. The relationship between consciousness and mental factors is compared to a king and his ministers. When the king travels, he does not travel alone, but he always travels accompanied by ministers. Similarly, whe never a consciousness arises, it never arises alone, but always accompanied by its associations of mental factors. Although the function of consciousness is to be a forerunner of the mental factors, the characteristic of consciousness is just pure awareness of an object, it cannot by itself be good or evil. It becomes good or evil depending on the associated mental factors. Therefore, to cultivate good and avoid all evil, it is essential to study the different types of mental factors and their characteristics. Defilements arise in the form of mental factors. They arise frequently in daily life owing to unwise attention. By studying and understanding their characteristics, one should be able to tackle them when they appear and to put a stop to them through right effort. On the other hand, when beautiful mental factors such as mindfulness, non-hatred, compassion arise, recognizing them, one should develop them to a higher degree. Like consciousness, mental factors also arise, perform their specific functions, and perish at tremendous speed with consciousness. Mental factors have four characteristics. 1. They must arise together with consciousness, ekapaweda. 2. They must cease together with consciousness, akanirodha. 3. They take the same object as consciousness, ekolabhava. For example, if I consciousness takes a visible object, then the associated mental factors also take the same visible object. 4. They have the same base as consciousness, ekavathuka. Except for the five types of sense consciousness, nai consciousness, kakuvioa, ear consciousness, sotavioa, nose consciousness, gainavioa, tongue consciousness, jivuevioa, and body consciousness, koyavioa, which arise dependent on their respective sense sensitivities, all consciousness arises dependent upon the heart base, hadayavathu, which is situated in the blood inside the heart. The associated mental factors also arise dependent upon the same heart base. 52 mental factors. In Inhidhamma we have 52 mental factors, which can be divided into four groups. 1. 7 universals, Sabbasiddhisoedhoroa. 2. 6 occasionals, Pakkhyoaka. 3. 14 unwholesome factors, Akusalestasika. 4. 25 beautiful factors, Sobhavasiddhisika. 1. 7 universals. 1. Contact, Fasa, it touches, thus it is contact. It is not necessarily bodily contact, it can be a mental state, such as the visible object touching the eye sensitivity, as when one sees someone eating pineapple, and saliva starts to flow in the mouth. This is also owing to contact. Contact causes the consciousness and the object to impinge. Without contact, no cognitive process will occur. 2. Feeling, Vedanoi, it experiences the taste of the object, whether it is desirable or undesirable. The feeling that enjoys or experiences the desirable aspect of the object is called pleasant feeling, sukha-vedanoi. The feeling that enjoys or experiences the undesirable aspect of the object is called unpleasant feeling, dukha-vedanoi. In some objects in which the tastes are neutral or not evidently good or bad, the feeling that enjoys or experiences that taste is called neutral feeling, upekavedanoi. Apart from the mental factors of feeling, which enjoys the desirable and undesirable of objects, there is no I, he, she, or a being who enjoys the taste of the objects. 3. Perception, Sa'oui, it perceives the qualities of the object and makes a sign or mark as a condition to perceive again that this is the same, or recognizing what has previously been perceived. For example, for the first time when one sees bird, one makes a sign that bird has wings and flies in the sky. So the wings and flying in the sky become conditions for recognizing a bird when one sees a bird again. Perception also sometimes takes wrong to be right. Owing to distorted perception, Sa'oui by Paloisa, human beings perceive all formations to be permanent, satisfactory, and of a self, which contradicts what the noble ones perceive as impermanent, unsatisfactory, and non-self. Once the phenomenon is perceived wrongly and is deeply imprinted in the mind, it becomes difficult to correct. Thus, perception, Sa'oui, becomes one of the factors prolonging the cycle of repeated births, Sa'time Sora. 4. Volition, Setanoi, it wills or accumulates karma, thus it is volition. It also organizes or urges its associated mental factors in acting upon the object. For instance, when consciousness is aware of some kind of object, its associated mental factor of volition urges contact to perform its function of causing consciousness and the object to impinge, urges perception to make a mark of it, urges feeling to enjoy or experience the taste of the object. It urges other associated mental factors to perform their respective functions thoroughly, so that they all are as if stuck to the object. The marshalling force which urges and prompts the consciousness and mental factors to be always engaged together on the object is none other than volition. Thus, volition has a double task. It accomplishes its own function of accumulating karma only when it associates with wholesome consciousness and unwholesome consciousness. One urges associated mental factors to do their work, just as a senior pupil who not only recites his lessons himself but urges others to recite theirs as well. If the volition, the will, or the inner urge is feeble, the consciousness is also feeble, and so are other mental factors. But when the volition, the will, or the urge is forceful and eager, consciousness and all other mental factors will follow suit. When consciousness and mental factors are forceful and eager, the physical body will also become alert and active. It is the function of volition to accumulate karma and supervise all the actions of body, speech, and mind. That is why the Buddha, assigning the responsibility to volition, said, Bhikkhus, it is volition that I call karma, for having willed, one performs an action through body, speech or mind. Following this statement, note that when volition is forceful, karma is strong, when volition is feeble, karma is weak, as was the case with Queen Somovit Squared and Mogandeyo. The story of Somovit Squared showed the efficacy of volition that gave rise to result. Somovit Squared was one of the King Udena's queens who had attained the stage of Stream Enterer. She has strong love for all beings and could suffuse everyone with loving kindness and compassion. Among all the women lay disciple, she was foremost in spreading loving kindness. One, the volition which associates with resultant consciousness and functional consciousness does not motivate wholesome and unwholesome karma. Mogandeyo, the other wife of King Udena, out of hatred to the Buddha, harbored bitterness towards Somovit Squared for being a pious disciple of Buddha. She held a bad volition to kill her. She set the whole palace of Somovit Squared on fire, in such a way that it would appear to be an accident. The whole women's palace was burnt and all the women residing in it were killed, including Somovit Squared. Why should such a kind-hearted and faithful disciple end up with such a terrible death? 1. The Buddha revealed that she had committed a bad deed many lifetimes ago, when she was queen of Benares. She was bathing with her ladies in whiting and feeling cold afterwards, she had asked that a bush be burnt to give some warmth. However, it was too late to spot a Paksekha Buddha sitting in deep concentration within the bush. The Paksekha Buddha had entered into the attainment of cessation. This was done without the bad volition to kill, therefore it was not considered an unwholesome karma. However, the entourage did not know that he was unharmed and feared that they would be blamed for lighting the fire without due caution. To obliterate their mistake, they gathered more grass, placed it around his body, poured oil over the Paksekha Buddha and set fire to burn him. They now burnt the Paksekha Buddha with evil volition, and much unwholesome karma were accumulated. Many unwholesome jivanas were occurring in their mental stream that left behind painful results. Any non-returner and arahant, including Paksekha Buddha and Sammasambuddha, who enters into attainment of cessation, cannot be killed by anyone. However, the evil intention and attempted murder, which is volition or karma, by Somovit Squared had to bear fruit, and it was in this lifetime that the result had again ripened one. Except those who attained the final cessation of five aggregates Kandapura Nibbana, no one could escape from the ripening of bad volition or karma. King Udena was greatly enraged with such atrocities and had Mogandeya and her relatives publicly burnt, then had the earth plowed under so that all traces of the ashes were destroyed. The king had her killed with utmost cruelty. The result returned to her exactly the same as what she had done to others. This is immediate effective karma of her bad deed, ripen in this very life. She died with intense pain and was reborn in hell for greater torture. This is subsequently effective karma which bear its result in the immediate next life. Uncountable indefinitely effective karma generated by the second to the sixth jivanas lie dormant in her mental stream, waiting for the right conditions to ripen, for further suffering. One, however, she was reborn in the Deva realm. That is why the Buddha said that volition is karma, for having willed, one performs an action through body, speech or mind. Therefore, when volition is forceful, karma is strong, and when karma is strong, the result is heavy. 5. One-pointedness, ekagat oe, fixes the mind on its object and is the state of collecting the mind. When consciousness is aware of an object, it is with the help of this mental factor of one-pointedness that it can be aware of the object repeatedly and for a long time. When developed, it becomes concentration and is one of the junic factors in all of the jhayanas. It opposes distraction. It should be regarded as steadiness of the mind, like the steadiness of a lamp's flame when there is no draft. One-pointedness accompanies every consciousness, although its quality is different when it arises with different consciousness. One-pointedness that accompanies unwholesome consciousness is called mikasamodhi, wrong concentration. One-pointedness accompanying wholesome consciousness is called samosamodhi, right concentration. Although both are the mental factor of one-pointedness, their qualities are different. There are many levels of concentration, first jhayana concentration, second jhayana concentration, and so on. 6. Life faculty, jivitindriya, it sustains the vitality of the consciousness and mental factors so that they will remain alive and endure for their full life. Otherwise, they will perish before the task of getting or knowing that object is complete. Just as lotus flowers are sustained by water, consciousness and the associated mental factors are sustained by the mental life faculty. So, all consciousness and mental factors can function actively because of the life force of it. 7. Attention, manasikara, it adverts and directs the mind to the object. It is regarded as the charioteer of associated mental states because it regulates the object. It is only because of the power of attention that one or another object is constantly present in the mind. These 7 universals must arise with all consciousness, whether it is wholesome, unwholesome, resultant, or functional. Without these 7 universal mental factors, consciousness of an object would be utterly impossible. 2. 6 occasionals. 1. Initial application of mind vidika, it is the initial application of the mind to the object, or placing the mind on the object. 2. Sustained application of mind vikora, sustaining application of the mind on the object by letting it examine the object again and again. After vidika places the mind on the object, vikara sustains it repeatedly so that it stays there for some time. 3. Decision, adimokkha, it has the characteristic of conviction, a firm state of mind free from wavering, which makes a conclusion, just this one. The decision determines whether to do good deeds such as giving, observing morality, listening to the Dhamma discourse, etc., or to do bad deeds such as telling what is not true, sexual misconduct, etc. It is compared to a stone pillar owing to its unshakable resolve regarding the object. 4. Energy, Riya, energy is the state of one who is vigorous. Its characteristic is supporting, exertion, and marshalling. As an old house stands when supported by new pillars, so the aspiring meditator, when supported by energy, does not fall away from his meditation. Energy does not allow its associated states to recede or to retreat, it uplifts and supports them so that they will not collapse. Its proximate cause is a sense of urgency or grounds for the initiation of energy. Birth, old age, and death can remind us of the urgency to develop right understanding through meditation, which will eventually lead to freedom from the cycle of birth and death. When rightly initiated, energy should be regarded as the root of all achievements. 5. Joy or rapture, piti, it is pleasurable interest of mind towards the object. It is satisfied, delighted with the object and it refreshes consciousness and the associated mental factors. If a weary traveler in the desert sees the availability of water, he will feel satisfied. Its function is to pervade or to thrill with rapture. When meditators develop deep concentration, they find the lightness of the body as if their body were lifted in the air. This is the manifestation of rapture. 6. Desire, Chanda. It is wished desire to act or achieve some result. It is different from greed, lobha, which is an unwholesome mental factor. When one wishes to realize Nibbana, to become a great disciple, a chief disciple, a Buddha, a king, a rich man, a Deva, a Brahma, a Bhikkhu, or a hermit, to give charity, to observe precepts, to do good deeds, etc., all such wishes belong to the realm of desire. When desire is developed to the utmost degree, it becomes one of the four means to accomplishment, itapoeta. An excellent example was when King Dhammasinda of Benares, during the time of the Kassapa Buddha, owing to his strong desire to listen to a discourse of Kassapa Buddha, abandoned the kingdom to Rome, seeking anyone who could repeat to him a discourse, despite being only a short stanza of Dhamma. These 6 occasional mental factors arise only with particular types of consciousness, not with all. For example, initial application and sustained application are excluded from third jhana consciousness and other higher jhanas because of their grossness. Decision is excluded from the doubting consciousness because a decision cannot be made while the mind is obstructed by doubt. Energy is excluded from the 5-door adverting consciousness, the receiving consciousness, and the investigating consciousness because these consciousness are still of a relatively weak and passive nature. Joy is excluded from the 4th jhana and other higher jhanas because of its emotion. Desire is excluded from consciousness rooted in delusion. Desire here is desire to act, to achieve a purpose, and the 2 consciousness rooted in delusion are so dense that they exclude purposeful action. The 7 universals and 6 occasionals are ethically variable factors, as samanoi cetasika, which means in wholesome consciousness they become wholesome, in unwholesome consciousness they become unwholesome, in resultant consciousness they become resultants, in functional consciousness they become functional. 3. 14 unwholesome factors. 4 unwholesome universals. 1. Delusion, MOHA. Delusion has the characteristic of blindness. It is mental blindness to the true nature of the object as impermanence, unsatisfactoriness, and non-self. Its function is to conceal the individual essence of an object. Unable to discern between what is wholesome and unwholesome is gross delusion. 2. Shamelessness, Ahirika. All evil deeds are like feces. Absence of disgust at bodily and verbal misconduct is called shamelessness. Just like a village pig does not feel loathsome when eating dirty food, so a person covered by delusion does not feel shameful when doing evil deeds. When delusion arises, it leads to shamelessness. Even the wise do wrong shamelessly when deluded. 3. Fearlessness of wrongdoing, anadapa. Fearlessness of wrongdoing is not being afraid of the consequences of committing evil deeds. Like a moth that is attracted to a flame and burns itself in the fire, a person who does not have moral dread due to delusion is attracted by evil doing and suffers the consequences this life and in lives hereafter. 4. Restlessness, Udaka. It has the characteristic of disquiet or of an unsettled state of mind, like water whipped up by the wind. The mind is unable to rest quietly on an object but flits about from object to object, like a heap of ashes that flies about when hit with a stone. These 4 unwholesome universals must arise together with all 12 types of unwholesome consciousness, for every unwholesome consciousness involves a mental blindness, MOHA, to the danger and evil, a lack of shame at evil deeds, Ahirika, for not being afraid of the consequences of evil deeds, Anadapa, and an underlying current of restlessness, Udaka. B. 10 unwholesome occasionals. 1. Greed, lobha, a strong desire for an object or grasping an object and not wanting to give it up. Its function is to stick, like meat in a hot pan. Its proximate cause is seeing enjoyment in things that lead to bondage, like pleasant sights, sounds, smells, tastes, and touch. The nature of greed and attachment can be illustrated by the simile of the monkey catching glue. The glue is put on the trunks of trees in a forest. A monkey, out of curiosity at the light catching the glue at a certain angle and producing colorful patterns, touches the glue with one paw, which becomes stuck to the tree. In an effort to free his first paw, he puts his other paw on the tree, and it also becomes stuck. And so on with his feet and finally with his head, which all become stuck to the tree. Now the monkey catcher is able to find and catch the monkey easily. Swelling with the current of craving for sensual pleasures and existence, greed or craving should be regarded as taking beings into the cycle of birth and death. 2. Wrong view, diahi. It has the characteristics of unwise interpretation. It takes the wrong view that self and persons really exist. Believing in the mighty creator of the world when there is none is also wrong view. Believing everything perishes after death or denying karma and its consequences is also wrong view. It should be regarded as the most reprehensible of all. 3. Conceit Moina. Conceit has the characteristic of haughtiness. It is wrongly grasping mind and matter as I am, and forming ideas of superiority, equality, or inferiority according to caste, family, education, birth, etc. It is easy to have conceit when one is superior over others or equal to others. How does the inferior one develop conceit? He considers, I live self-sufficient. Why should I show respect to others? Though inferior to others, he will still be conceited. Conceit should be regarded as madness. It is rooted in greed. 4. Hatred, dosa, it is aversion, resentment, irritation, annoyance and anger. It is a violent striking of the mind at an object, with the destructive element that burns oneself and others. 5. Envy, iso, it is being jealous of others or lack of appreciation for others' success and achievement. Envy easily arises when others are superior to one in beauty, education, wealth, and reputation. It is rooted in hatred. 6. Avarice, Makariya, it is the concealment of one's own success and unwillingness to share with others. It also means wishing others to get nothing. It is rooted in hatred. 7. Worry, Kakuka, there are two kinds of remorse, anxiety or remorse over what one has done or has not done. For example, what had been done could be killing, taking what has not been given, sexual misconduct, false or harmful speech, and taking intoxicants. And what has not been done could include not taking care of one's parents while they are alive, not practicing morality when there is opportunity, not practicing generosity when you can afford to give, not offering help to those in need, etc. Worry should be regarded as slavery. It is rooted in hatred. However, regret over past wrong deeds will not help oneself. Regret or remorse will not deliver you from painful consequences. If you let remorse obsess your mind, unwholesome subconsciousness will arise successively and repeatedly. That remorse will reoccur in one's mental stream during dying moments, as it happened to Queen Maliko. Shortly before death, Queen Maliko, the great supporter of the Buddha, kept on remembering with remorse a misdeed she had performed to her husband. The memory reoccurred just before her dying moment and she was cast to hell for 7 days. This subsequently effective karma is generated by the seventh jhāvana, which produces its result in the immediate future life. Nevertheless, the unwholesome karma was not very severe. After 7 days, due to the ripening of Queen Maliko's previous good karma, she was able to escape from hell and was reborn in heaven. The correct way to overcome remorse is to avoid doing evil deeds again, to make a firm resolution to refrain from akusala, evil action. If the evil deeds are not too serious, one will escape their evil results or lessen the painful consequences by virtue of one's restraint, as it happened to Agulimola. Through the outrageous demand of his previous teacher, Agulimola had killed 999 innocent human beings. The Buddha, out of compassion for this misguided man, came to save him. Realizing his own fault, Agulimola gave up the cruelty for the going forth to be a bhikkhu and with resolution, he practiced self-restraint. Since then he had never harmed any beings intentionally. Through unrelenting effort and mature perfection, he finally achieved Arahant path and fruition knowledge. Since he had brought the end of the round of rebirths in this very life, he had escaped from the evil result in future. The subsequently effective karma and definitely effective karma had become defunct karma by his attainment of Arahant path knowledge. However, he still has to face the maturing of immediately effective karma in this present life. During his alms rounds, he was frequently attacked with sticks and stones causing serious physical injuries with blood flowing from his head. The Buddha urged him to bear it and reminded him that it was the results of his previous deeds, or else he might have been tortured in hell for many thousands of years. Regarding good deeds one has not done, one should not lament over it. It is never too late to mend. Do it now. Remorse is the great hindrance for meditation progress. 8. Sloth Thana, this is sluggishness or dullness of consciousness towards an object. It has the characteristic of lacking driving power and the function of removing energy. 9. Torpor, Mitta, this is sluggishness or dullness of mental factors. It has the characteristic of unwieldiness and is manifested as laziness or drowsiness. 10. Doubt Vichikiko, it is perplexity and indecisiveness, not believing what ought to be believed, such as the three trainings in morality, concentration, and wisdom or the three refuges of Buddha, Dhamma, and Sangha. The 10 unwholesome occasionals arise with particular types of unwholesome consciousness, but not with all. Wrong view and conceit are found only with the consciousness rooted in greed, for they mistaken the five aggregates as myself, or as I am. However, they cannot coexist in the same consciousness moment. Let's say, when you feel more superior in wealth and beauty, at that moment the consciousness rooted in greed, headed by conceit, arise in the jivana stages repeatedly. Envy, avarice, and worry are found only with the consciousness rooted in anger. But since they exhibit different qualities and take different objects, they only arise in different cognitive processes. Envy involves resentment against the success of others, avarice involves unwillingness to share one's property with others, worry involves remorse over what one has done or not done, with anger as root. Doubt is found only in the consciousness rooted in sheer delusion. These are 14 unwholesome mental factors that contaminate the consciousness. Although they are small in number, they occur very often in worldlings pathujana. In Pali, pathujana means produce a lot of defilements, pathu kilis genetiti, pathujano, because the nature of mind is to delight in evil. This may be proven by the fact that when you read a newspaper, the news concerning crime, violence, war, rape, sexual abuse, fraud, and so on declares how often most worldlings' minds are overwhelmed with greed, hatred, and delusion. The world, owing to the unwholesome mental factors, is full of turmoil. In our daily lives, if we examine closely how time is spent, we will realize how often we indulge in sensual pleasures. Most of the people cannot live happily without the entertainment of television, music, songs, drinking alcohol, pleasant touch like sexual intercourse, etc. Pleasant sights, sounds, smells, tastes, and touch induce greed and leave behind that tendency in one's mental stream. Excessive indulgence in them will cause one to have a kind of temperament full of greed and lust in the present life as well as the future. For certain people, when their desire and selfish motive are not fulfilled, they turn to rage and violence. When this anger is put into action and words, they in turn engage in killing, stealing, sexual abuse, lying, slandering, murdering, and so on without mercy and compassion for others' suffering. Thus, people are revolving in the whirlpool of delusion, greed, and hatred, which brings suffering to oneself and others. To avoid unwholesome mental factors dominating us, we should cultivate more beautiful mental factors. There are 25 of them. 4. 25 beautiful factors of 19 beautiful universals. 1. Faith, sado, it is confidence in wholesomeness, believing in what ought to be believed in, for example, karma and its consequences, and past and future existences. A person without faith, when entering into the dispensation of the Buddha, cannot grasp the essence of the teachings. Faith has the ability to purify, like a water-clearing gem which, when put into muddy water, causes the impurities and sediments to sink and makes the water become crystal clear. So the arising of faith discards the hindrances, causes the mental corruptions to subside, purifies the mind, and makes it undisturbed. The mind being purified, the devoted one gives gifts, observes the precepts, and cultivates the mental development of concentration and insight with clarity. Thus it is said, one with faith can set forth on the path of generosity, morality, and mental development. Its proximate cause is hearing the good Dhamma, which is necessary for the attainment of stream entry. Nowadays, no one is able to attain stream entry without first listening to the Dhamma or instruction on how to practice. 2. Mindfulness, sati. Mindfulness has the characteristic of not floating away from the object, like a pumpkin that is thrown into water will float away, but sinking into the object, like a stone that is thrown into the water sinks to the bottom. This can be clearly experienced in meditation practice. For example, when you are practicing mindfulness of breathing, anopanasati, mindfulness makes your mind sink deeply into the object of the breath, and not lose the object. In insight meditation, mindfulness makes your mind sink into the impermanent, suffering, non-self nature of all phenomena. Mindfulness is also constant wakefulness in good things, like looking forward to performing generosity, which one needs to do, taking care to observe five precepts and not to breach any of them, practicing samatha and vipassana regularly, listening attentively to the Dhamma discourses, and so on. Mindfulness is purely a wholesome mental factor, there is no wrong mindfulness like wrong concentration or wrong view. Mindfulness is also compared to a gatekeeper or guardian, which guards all the six senses so the defilements cannot enter. Mindfulness is always necessary to balance faith with wisdom, concentration with effort, and concentration with wisdom. Mindfulness is desirable under all circumstances because it protects the mind from becoming agitated due to excess effort. It also protects the mind from falling into laziness because of excess concentration. Therefore, it is necessary to have mindfulness under all circumstances, as the seasoning of salt is in all sauces. Hence, the Blessed One said, mindfulness is always necessary in any meditation subject. Why is that? It is because mindfulness is a refuge and protection for the meditating mind. It is a refuge because it helps the mind arrive at special and high states it has never reached or known before. Without it, the mind is not capable of attaining any special and extraordinary states. To one who discerns mindfulness with insight knowledge, it appears as that which protects the object of meditation not to be lost, as well as the mind of the meditator not to go to other objects. Without mindfulness, a person is unable to lift up the mind or restrain the mind. That is why the Buddha has said it is useful in all instances. 3. Shame, Kiri. Shame has the characteristic of disgust at bodily and verbal misconduct. One is ashamed of performing evil deeds, after reflecting on the worth of one's birth, education, age, and social status. How? The one born in a good family reflects thus, I belong to a good family. It is not fit, proper, and is shameful to steal or utter untrue or harsh words. The well-known one reflects thus, I am well respected by others. If I commit evil like sexual abuse, slandering, or being drunk in public, it would be a great shame. So they reject evil out of respect for themselves. People who has shame, recoils from evil like a cock's feather shrinks in front of fire. Its proximate cause is self-respect. 4. Fear of wrongdoing, Adapa. Adapa has the characteristic of fear or dread in doing evil after considering the painful consequences of evil deeds, such as self-blame, blame from others, punishment by the law, and suffering in the four woeful planes. How? A person reflects, if I commit evil, I will be reproached or blamed by my parents and teachers. If my evil action is revealed, I might be put into prison. Thus, he refrains from committing evil. There is a simile to DESC Rive, shame and fear of wrongdoing. If there is an iron rod, and one end is heated and the other is smeared with feces, one would not touch the end smeared with feces due to disgust and would not touch the heated end due to fear. The former is compared to shame, the latter to fear of wrongdoing. These two states should be regarded as the guardians of the world, as they prohibit beings from doing wrong actions. If human beings can develop these two beautiful qualities earnestly, the world will be a peaceful place to live in. These are the two of seven noble treasures of a stream enterer. 1. 5. Non-greed, Aloba. Non-greed has the characteristic of the mind's lack of desire for the object or non-adherence to the object, like a drop of water that runs off a lotus leaf without adhering to it, or like a man who has fallen into filth without desire for it. Non-greed includes generosity. When you are able to give away your property and your money, it shows you have no greed towards them. And it also includes renunciation, the ability to renounce worldly life, family, and the five cords of sensual pleasure and stay in solitude as a quality of renunciation based on non-greed. 6. Non-hatred, Adosa. Non-hatred has the characteristic of lack of ferocity, like a gentle, good friend. It is manifested as agreeableness, like the full moon, like by everybody. Loving kindness includes forgiveness and harmlessness, which is the positive state of non-hatred. The story of the novice of the elder Tissa showed the beauty of non-hatred. Elder Tissa ordained his attendant, a 7-year-old novice. He taught him to contemplate the impurities of 32 parts of the body. The instant the razor touched his hair, the boy attained arahatship. In one of the journeys, after 3 days, the novice had occupied the same lodging with his preceptor. He was mindful not to allow his preceptor to commit the offense of sleeping in common, too, hence he sat up the whole night, unknown to the elder. The elder, being concerned about the same. 1. 7 noble treasures, faith, generosity, morality, shame of wrongdoing, fear of wrongdoing, learning and wisdom. 2. The fifth offense of expiation, should any bhikkhu sleep for more than 2 or 3 nights along with one not fully ordained, as a bhikkhu, this entails expiation. Offense, threw a fan at the novice to get him out of the room. The handle of the fan struck the novice in the eye and straightaway put out his eye. This novice wished to spare his preceptor's remorse, did not tell him the real facts, and covering his eye with one hand, he faithfully continued his duties for his preceptor. It was only later that the elder discovered what had happened and was deeply moved. He bowed to the 7-year-old novice and asked for forgiveness. The novice consoled him and said, you are not to be blamed in this matter and neither am I. The round of existences alone is to be blamed for this. With great remorse, the elder related the whole situation to the Buddha. The novice even comforted his preceptor, cherished neither hatred nor anger towards him. The Buddha said, "Monks, those who have rid themselves of the taints cherish neither anger nor hatred towards anyone. On the contrary, their senses are in a state of calm and their thoughts are in a state of calm." 7. Neutrality of mind, Tatramajadado, it is keeping in the middle of all things. The mental attitude of balance and impartiality, that neither clings to an object nor rejects it. When developed, neutrality of mind becomes equanimity, one of the four sublime abidings. And this equanimity towards all beings comes from the understanding that all beings have karma as their heritage. One must develop loving kindness, compassion, and sympathetic joy before developing equanimity. It is attained in the fifth jhayana. Its near enemy is indifference from lack of understanding. The following 12 mental factors are grouped into 6 pairs. Of each pair, one pertains to mental factors and the other pertains to consciousness. 8. Tranquility of mental body, Koyapasiddhi. 9. Tranquility of consciousness, Siddhapasiddhi, the composure of consciousness and the mental factors, in that they are at rest and become cool. It is opposed to the defilements of restlessness and worry, which create annoyance. 10. Lightness of mental body, Koyalahuto. 11. Lightness of consciousness, Siddhalahuto, lightness of mental body and lightness of consciousness block out the heaviness in consciousness and the mental factors that are caused by sloth and torpor. 12. Malleability of mental body, Koyamududo. 13. Malleability of consciousness, Siddhamududo. Malleability of mental body and malleability of consciousness are the pliancy of mind that overcomes the rigidity of consciousness and the mental factors caused by defilements such as wrong view and conceit. 14. Wieldiness of mental body, Koyakama Ato. 15. Wieldiness of consciousness, Siddhakama Ato. Wieldiness of mental body and wieldiness of consciousness are the adaptability of consciousness and the mental factors in carrying out their beneficial work. It's compared to heated gold, which is made fit for any use. 16. Proficiency of mental body, Koyapoguato. 17. Proficiency of consciousness, Siddhapoguato. Proficiency of mental body and proficiency of consciousness are the skillfulness and healthiness of consciousness and the mental factors. They suppress the sickness of mind caused by the passions and lack of faith. 18. Rectitude of mental body, Koyujukadoi. 19. Rectitude of consciousness, Siddhajukado. Rectitude of mental body and rectitude of consciousness are the strictness and uprightness of consciousness with the mental factors that opposes crookedness, deception and hypocrisy, etc. These 19 beautiful universals arise together with all wholesome consciousness. For instance, when one performs generosity, keeps morality, or practices samatha or vipassana meditation, listening to the Dhamma, sharing merits with others, serving the parents or elders, teaching Dhamma. B. 3 abstinences. 1. Right speech, sammāvacca, abstaining from the fourfold wrong speech, false speech, slandering, harsh speech, and frivolous talk, even though one has a chance to commit them. 2. Right action, sammokkhamanta, abstaining from the threefold wrong action, killing, stealing, and sexual misconduct, even though you have a chance to commit them. 3. Right livelihood, sammoavayava, abstaining from the fivefold wrong, trading, selling poisons, intoxicants, weapons, slaves, or animals for slaughter. Property or wealth gained by the aforementioned four types of wrong speech and three wrong actions are also considered wrong livelihood. The three abstinences associated with wholesome sense sphere consciousness arise separately only on the occasio and when one intentionally refrains from wrong speech, action, or livelihood for which an opportunity has arisen. For example, when one is quick to utter harsh speech after being prompted, he refrains and abstains from it because of the shame and fear of wrongdoing. At that moment, among the three abstinence only mental factor of right speech arises. The same applies to right action, when you meet with the opportunity to take life. For instance, wanting to kill the mosquito which is now sucking your blood, but you abstain from it, fearing the consequences of killing. But in supramundane consciousness, like path consciousness, these three abstinences necessarily arise together as the three factors in the morality group of the Noble Eightfold Path functioning to eliminate permanently the evils associated with wrong speech, action, and livelihood. See two illimitables. 1. Compassion, Karuwoi, the wish to remove or to alleviate the suffering of others or being unable to bear others' suffering. Karuwoi is defined as the quality which makes the heart of the good man tremble and quiver at the suffering of others. When seeing others in misery, the wish to help them and alleviate their pain is aroused in one who is compassionate. He strives and actually renders the help to remove their suffering. But, if he fails, he does not give in to sadness, understanding that all beings are the owners of their karma, and have karma as their heritage. It is this great compassion, being unable to see all beings drowning in aging, sickness, death and suffering incessantly in the four woeful states, that spurred on the hermit Sumita, the Bodhisattva, to boldly give up his attainment of arahantship in that life. Instead, he strived strenuously for four asakaya and 100,000 kappas to become the supremely enlightened one, in order to show the path to all beings, who are floating in the ocean of birth and death endlessly. 2. Appreciative joy, manito, this means rejoicing or delighting in others' success, achievement and prosperity. They applaud the success of other people with sincerity and with the thought, may this being be not separated from the prosperity he has attained. These two are called illimitables because they are to be developed towards all living beings without limit. The other two divine abodes, Brahma Vihara, loving-kindness and equanimity, come under the mental factors of non-hatred and neutrality of mind, respectively. Compassion and appreciative joy will only arise separately from each other and only when the condition for them to arise is fulfilled, because they each take a different object. Compassion takes the suffering of others while appreciative joy takes others' success. D. 1. Non-delusion. 1. Wisdom faculty, amoha, wisdom has the characteristic of penetrating into things as they really are, as impermanence, unsatisfactoriness, and non-self. It removes ignorance, which covers the four noble truths. It is manifested as non-bewilderment, like a guide in the forest. Wisdom is necessary for understanding G, and its results, understanding the scriptures or Dhamma sermons, and for the attainment of jhana, path and fruition. It is also called insight, paoe, knowledge, bijo, and right view, samuitihai. There are many kinds and degrees of wisdom. There can be wisdom which knows the benefit of wholesomeness and the disadvantages of unwholesomeness, there is wisdom which stems from contemplation on the shortness of life, and so on. These kinds of wisdom can arise even when one has not listened to the Dhamma. When one has studied the Dhamma, there is intellectual understanding about ultimate mind, matter, and their causes, i.e., the activity of the law of karma and its results. When wisdom develops further through the development of meditation, there is direct understanding of ultimate mind, matter, dependent origination, to the extent of realizing nibbana. Seeing phenomenon, dhammas, as they really are is the goal of the Buddha's teachings. Developed wisdom knows what is real in the ultimate sense and what is not real. So long as there is wrong view, we cannot see the ultimate realities of mind and body as they really are. Wisdom is one of the spiritual faculties, indriyas, which has to be developed together with the other spiritual faculties of confidence or faith, satta, energy, viriya, mindfulness, sati, and concentration, samadhi. Through the equal development of these five faculties, the four noble truths will be realized. Wisdom's proximate cause is concentration, because the Buddha says, one who has concentration, knows and sees the Dhammas as they really are. These are all the 52 mental factors. They arise in a certain group with appropriate state of consciousness. Unravel the mysteries of mental factors. Mental factors, when accompanying with consciousness, assist consciousness perform more specific tasks in the total act of cognition. A practical example will make this clear. When you are eating, how does consciousness work and how do the mental factors help the consciousness in the whole process of eating or drinking wine? At that moment, consciousness is just aware of the taste, that's all. Pure awareness of the taste is the characteristic of consciousness. The mental factor of contact performs the function of causing the consciousness and taste to impinge. Without contact, consciousness of an object would be impossible. The mental factor of feeling experiences the taste, enjoys the desirable aspect of the taste. Apart from the mental factor of feeling, there is no self who experiences it. The mental factor of perception performs the function of making a sign or a mark as a condition for perceiving it again, this is the same sweet taste, this is the same sweet taste, etc. And the mental factor of volition performs the function of organizing or urging all the associated mental factors to act upon that taste, and it itself generates karma rooted in greed. The mental factor of one-pointedness fixes all the mental factors towards the taste. The mental factor of life faculty sustains the vitality of associated mental factors so that they will remain alive and endure until they finish the task. And the mental factor of attention directs the mind to the taste, adverting to the taste. This is how the seven universal mental factors, cetasikas, assist consciousness in the total act of cognition. The six occasionals mental factors also act to assist consciousness. The mental factor of initial application of mind acts to place the associated mental factors onto the taste. Mental factor of sustained application of mind sustains the associated mental factors on the taste by letting it examine the taste again and again. The mental factor of decision decides good sweet taste, etc. The mental factor of energy supports the associated mental factors so they will not collapse or retreat, especially helping greed to arise. Mental factor of joy keeps a joyful interest in the taste. And the mental factor of desire is the desire to get the taste, or to let greed arise. Then there are the four unwholesome universal mental factors, which arise with every unwholesome consciousness. The mental factor of delusion conceals the true nature of the taste, which is impermanent, unsatisfactory, and impure in nature, instead of seeing the taste as permanent, satisfactory and pure. The mental factor of shamelessness is the lack of shame for the arising of greed while enjoying the taste. The mental factor of fearlessness of wrongdoing means not being afraid of the consequences of the arising of greed while enjoying the taste. The mental factor of restlessness makes the mind disquiet and distracted, not composed while enjoying the taste. Then we have the unwholesome occasionals mental factors, which arise only with certain types of unwholesome consciousness. In this case there is mental factor of greed, which keeps enjoying the taste, grasping onto the taste, not wanting to give up. The mental factor of wrong view interprets wrongly that food really exists in the ultimate sense. In all, there are 19 mental factors plus one unwholesome consciousness rooted in greed during the process of enjoying the food or drinking wine. Each consciousness and mental factors arises, performs its specific function and vanishes at tremendous speed. This process occurs successively at unwholesome jivana stage. As you already know, unwholesome kama is being performed and reinforced by the repeated unwholesome jivana processes. On the other hand, sometimes you cannot get your favorite taste that you are attached to, and due to unfulfilled desire or greed, agitation or anger arises in you. At that time, one consciousness rooted in anger, associated with 17 mental factors, one arises successively in your mental stream at the jivana stages, leaving behind unwholesome kamic potency, which will produce its bad result when matured. Be aware. On the other hand, if one engages in any wholesome deeds such as charity, 33 mental factors will arise at one's jivana stage s. They are the seven universals which must arise with every consciousness, six occasionals if one does it with joy, if not joy will be excluded, 19 beautiful universals which arise with all wholesome consciousness, and lastly, the wisdom faculty provided one performs it with the understanding of kama. Many wholesome kamas are being accumulated. Mental factors are not self. Having analyzed each associated mental factor and the specific function they perform, one comes to the realization there is no overlord I who exercise control over any process either of eating or performing charity. The wrong view of I or being comes through is not able to break down the compactness of the functions of mental factors. Therefore one mistakenly considers the feeling aggregate as I, perception aggregate as I, formation aggregate as I, and consciousness aggregate as I. They say, I enjoy the taste, I am a generous person. Thus the wrong view of I, or being, comes about. One excluding the mental factors of greed, wrong view, and joy, which only arise with consciousness rooted in greed. Greed and hatred, according to the Inhedhamma, are mutually exclusive, they cannot coexist within the same consciousness. So also wrong view cannot arise simultaneously with hatred in the same consciousness, but can arise at an earlier time in a different type of consciousness. Consciousness rooted in anger is necessarily accompanied by displeasure, not joy. Consciousness is like a car body. The mental factors are like the associated gear shift, gas, and steering in the car, which perform their specific functions in order to help the car move forward. Similarly, the mental factors help the consciousness in the total act of cognition, either in experiencing the taste, seeing the visible object, hearing the sound, smelling the smell, sensing the tangible object, or experiencing the mental object. Without the help of mental factors, consciousness cannot experience the object fully, and the whole cognitive process cannot take place. Consciousness can be compared to pure water, and the mental factors can be compared to different dyes. When you put yellow dye in pure water, it becomes yellow, if you put black dye into pure water it becomes black. Mental factors seduce the mind to become good or bad. The study of mental factors helps us to understand how the mind reacts when it comes to contact with any six sense objects, which is important to avoid what is harmful and cultivate what is beneficial to us. The functions that mental factors perform should not be wrongly considered as a permanent self or soul. Hence, mental factors are not self. Ch.4, matter, rupa. Matter, or materiality, the third ultimate reality, forms this so-called body. There are 28 kinds of materiality, called rupa in Pali. Four are primary materiality of earth, water, fire and wind. The remaining 24 are materialities derived from them. Matter does not arise singly, but in a group called rupa kalopa or subatomic particles. One rupa kalopa consists of a minimum of 8 materialities of earth element, water element, fire element, wind element, color, smell, taste and nutritive essence known as pure octet kalopa. These 8 are inseparable. All the materialities in a group arise together and cease together. Their occurrence depends on the 4 primary materialities. So they have the same common base. Why is materiality, the third ultimate reality, called rupa in Pali? The Pali word for rupa is derived from the verb rupati, which means to be deformed, disturbed, oppressed and broken. The Buddha himself explained that it is deformed, rupati, and therefore it is called material form. Deformed by what? Deformed by cold, by heat, by hunger, by thirst, by flies, mosquitoes, wind, sunburn, and creeping things. For instance, in a cold climate, skin cracks, in a hot climate because of excessive fire elements in each kalopa, skin gets inflamed and reddened, in hunger because of weakness of nutritive essence in each kalopa, the body becomes weak and fatigued. But this is merely the manifestation of conventional truth. The 4 primary materialities are also known as the 4 great elements, Mahopeta, of earth element, water element, fire element, and wind element are the primary material elements. These are the fundamental constituents of pure octet kalapa, earth element, water, fire, wind, color, smell, taste, nutritive essence, matter, which exist together. Every material substance, ranging from the smallest particles in our body to the most immense objects such as mountains and the sea, is made up of these 4 elements. They are called elements dhatu, in the sense that they bear their own intrinsic natures. These can easily be discerned by meditators who practice 4 elements meditation. They discern the intrinsic nature each element bears. Earth element bears the intrinsic nature of hardness and roughness. Water element bears the intrinsic nature of flowing and cohesion. Fire element bears the intrinsic nature of heat and cold, and wind element bears the intrinsic nature of motion and supporting. So the experience of 4 elements is not simply the earth, water, fire and wind as we know them in conventional truth. Why is it so important to understand materiality? In the Mahagopalaka Sutta, the Great Cowherd Sutta, the Buddha explains the knowledge of materiality that is necessary for a bhikkhu to progress in the Dhamma and Vinaya. How does a bhikkhu have knowledge of materiality? Here a bhikkhu understands as it really is, all materiality of whatever kind consists of the 4 great elements and materiality derived from the 4 great elements. That is how a bhikkhu has knowledge of materiality. And the Buddha says that without this knowledge, the bhikkhu is incapable of growth, increase, and fulfillment in this Dhamma and Vinaya. This means we need to know and see all 28 types of materiality, primary materiality and 24 derived materialities. 4 great elements. There are 4 great elements, earth element, water element, fire element and wind element. 1. Earth element. The earth element is so called because, like the earth, it serves as a support or foundation for the coexistent material phenomena. This is the element of extension. It is due to this element of extension that objects occupy space. The main characteristic of earth element is hardness, but it also includes roughness, heaviness, softness, smoothness and lightness. Whatever there is internally in oneself that is hard, harsh, soft, and clung to, acquired through kama, such as head hair, teeth, nails, bones, heart, spleen, bowels, etc., has earth element as predominant factor. 2. Water element. This is the element of cohesion that makes different matter within one kalapa cohere or hold together, preventing them from being scattered. The water element binds the other 3 elements of earth, wind and fire so that they can stand together and depend on one another. When water element which holds them together disappears, the other 3 elements also disappear instantaneously. Our limbs and organs are held together in proper position due to this element of cohesion. Materiality can exist in this world in various forms, sizes and dimension ranging from the tiniest atom to Mount Meru, on account of this water element. When cohesion in Mount Meru is removed, Mount Meru will disappear instantaneously. Why? Due to the non-cohesion to hold them together, the elements of earth, fire and wind, which are in Mount Meru, are unable to support one another and hence will disintegrate. Water element also has the characteristic of flowing. When water element is less, it coheres; when it is excessive, it flows. This can be tested by pouring a little water into flour. When water is less, the flour coheres. If more water is added, the flour flows. Whatever is internal in oneself that is water, watery, and clung to, like blood, pus, urine, grease, tears, sweat, fat, etc., has water element as predominant factor. 3. Fire element. This is the element of heat that matures, ripens, and ages other material phenomena. The liveliness of all beings and plants is preserved by this fire element. It also has the characteristic of cold. But heat and cold are relative. When you touch water and feel warmth, it is fire element. When it is not that warm, it is cold, it is also fire element. Fire element is manifested as a continuous supply of softness. Just like an iron bar becomes soft when continuously heated up by fire. The fruits continuously turn to softness after ripening. These are merely manifestations of fire element. Whatever is internal in one's body that is fire, fiery, and clung to and which causes what is eaten, drunk, chewed, and tasted to get completely digested in our stomach, is called the internal fire element. The body also grows old, wrinkles, weakens, gets gray hair, etc. due to the fire element. There are 4 components of the body in which fire element is predominant, namely heat that warms the body, heat that causes maturing and aging, heat of fever and digestive heat. We have indigestion because of weak digestive fire. The worried person ages faster because of excessive fire element. In our bodies, if fire element is moderate, we are healthy, if not, we are sick, and if it is in excess, we die. 4. Wind element. This is the element of motion and distension that causes material phenomena to move from one place to another. It has the characteristic of distension and supporting. It is manifested as conveyance to other places. We are able to sit erect because of the supporting, which is characteristic of the wind element. Wind element is experienced as tangible pressure. In our body there are 6 types of wind. I, wind that moves upwards, causing belching, coughs, sneezing and related illness. When we speak, this wind moves constantly upward and may cause bowel discomfort. E, wind that moves downwards, causing bowel movement infrequent. Motion. E, wind that moves about in the visceral cavity, apart from the large and small intestines. IV, wind that moves about inside the large and small intestines. The wind which is in the intestines push down the food that is eaten and whatever is eaten has to go through the rectum. B, wind that moves within the limbs. If this wind does not move freely, illness such as stroke results. In our bodies there are small veins along which this wind moves. B, wind inhaled and exhaled by us. If these 4 elements are well balanced, the body is in good shape, if not, we are sick. To keep the 4 elements in balance, depend on our mood and emotion, suitable climate, healthy food and also the past karma we had performed. The 28 kinds of matter chart 6. Concretely produced matter 18, non-concrete matter 10. Including the 4 elements, these are the mode or attribute of the 18 concretely produced matter. 4 great elements. 1. Earth element. 2. Water element. 3. Fire element. 4. Wind element. Dependent on these 4 elements, 24 materialities are derived. Sensitive phenomena. 5. Eye sensitivity. 6. Ear sensitivity. 7. Nose sensitivity. 8. Tongue sensitivity. 9. Body sensitivity. Objective phenomena. 10. Visible object. 11. Sound. 12. Smell. 13. Taste. Tangible objects are the 3 elements of earth, fire, and air. Sexual phenomena. 14. Femininity. 15. Masculinity. Heart phenomenon. 16. Heart base. Life phenomenon. 17. Life faculty. Nutritional phenomenon. 18. Nutriment. Limiting phenomenon. 19. Space element. Communicating phenomenon. 20. Bodily intimation. 21. Verbal intimation. Mutable phenomena. 22. Lightness. 23. Malleability. 24. Wieldiness plus 2 intimations. Characteristics of matter. 25. Production. 26. Continuity. 27. Decay. 28. Impermanence. 18. Concretely produced matter. They are called concretely produced matter because they possess intrinsic nature, suitable for contemplation by insight. These are divided into 7 classes. 1. 4 great elements, as discussed above. 2. 5 sensitive phenomena. There are 5 sensitive parts of the sense organs produced by past karma in the body, which can receive the corresponding sense object. They are eye sensitivity, ear sensitivity, nose sensitivity, tongue sensitivity, and body sensitivity. 2.1 Eye sensitivity takes visible object or color as object. It is the sensitive substance in the retina that registers color or light. It serves as physical base for eye consciousness. The impingement of color to eye sensitivity gives rise to eye consciousness. Eye sensitivity is to be found in eye decad kalopa. 2.2 Ear sensitivity takes sound as object. Ear sensitivity is the sensitive substance found inside the ear hole that registers sound. It serves as physical base for ear consciousness. The impingement of sound to ear sensitivity gives rise to ear consciousness. AR sensitivity is to be found in ear decad kalopa. Idecad kal oepa. Earth element. Water. Fire. Wind. Color. Smell. Taste. Nutritive essence.